Welcome to Podcastville, cocksuckers. This podcast is brought to you by Nature Box. Listen, you all want to eat better, but when it comes to snacks, sometimes it feels like the whole world is delicious and a billion calories versus boring and tasteless. It doesn't have to be that way. Up your snack game with Nature Box. And right now, what we're going to do is Nature Box is offering the family, you guys, 50% off your first order when you go to naturebox.com/Joey. I don't know if you know about Nature Box, but they have over 100 snacks that taste good and are actually better for you. All snacks are made from high quality, simple ingredients, which means no artificial flavors or sweeteners, so you can feel good about what you're eating. Listen to me. It gets delivered right to your house. You're having a good time. You're watching the movie. You're a little in the mood for a snack. There's Nature Box right there for you. Healthy, nutritious, and delicious. And like I said, I'm going to give you 50% off your first order when you go to naturebox.com/Joey. Again, naturebox.com/Joey. 50% off your first order. Number two, you're calling me all day. You're bothering me. Joey, I got locks. But what good is a lock if you got nobody dependable to put it in with? If you're watching games, that's one thing. It's time to start making money. MyBookie is the industry-leading website that hooks you up with all your betting needs. And with their great odds, fast payouts, and decades of expertise, you can bet with confidence. So what I'm going to do is this. Join today, MyBookie. I'm telling you, you guys are degenerate gamblers. You know I love you motherfuckers. I like to put a bet in from time to time. This is the way to go. MyBookie.ag. You join now, and MyBookie will match your deposit with up to 100% bonus. Use promo code CHURCH to activate the offer. Visit MyBookie.ag and use promo code CHURCH today. I'm going to break it down to you. You play, you win, you get paid. Go to MyBookie.ag. You're happy that you did. Tell them Uncle Joey sent you.
Time, where does it stop? Where do you dare me to draw the line? You got the body, now you want my soul. Don't even think about
greetings, you bad motherfuckers. Before we even start the podcast, obviously you guys have heard the horrible news. Our dear friend passed on Friday. A lot of you people hit me up and said if we could do like a memorial podcast. And I was going to have a bunch of people come in and call in and stuff like that. You know what? I knew Ralph for 20 years. I could do a fucking thing on him by myself. Backwards. I got my little brother, Steve Simone, who's got a heart of gold. And the fucking Christ killers here, as usual. Fucked up to the gills. What's happening, gentlemen?
How are you, Joey?
Good, good. Friday, I'm in jiu-jitsu. I walk out the door. I got no calls. I get in the car. I start the car. And all of a sudden, I get a call from a dear friend. And when I answered, she was crying. And I knew right there what she was crying about because she spoke to Ralphie all the time. It was his longtime friend and publicist, Stacy Pocoluto. And, I came up with Stacy and I heard her crying and I knew right away. And I drove home. You called at one point. The phone started ringing. She told me not to say nothing. Because the family didn't know yet, but then it was too late. By the time I got home, TMZ had released it, and then the phone started ringing, and I just sat there fucking confused. I didn't know. I couldn't put the pieces together. I called my wife. She was a target. She fucking lost it. Mm. You know, my wife loved him to death. You know, he gave us a crib. You know, we didn't ask him for a fucking crib. He goes, Yeah, I'm going to give you something for the baby. And all of a sudden, fucking UPS is knocking on the door with a fucking crib that's worth $10,000 with buttons. And it was just, so I knew it was going to kill her. He knew what she liked, the southern shit that they grew up on.
Yeah.
So, then, like, she was crying about that the other day. He's the only one who knew what mud pies were, or some shit, you know. But it was even sad. And then the call started coming in from all over. I called my brother George, who was walking into our grandmother's wake.
Oh, God.
And I go, you ready? I go, I even got worse news for you, George. Ralphie's gone. And, you know, he called me on later at that night. He was dealing with his grandmother's fucking death. And all of a sudden, I piled Ralphie on him. And I felt bad after I did it. But I didn't want him to hear it somewhere.
Yeah, you had to.
I called my friend Pete in Houston, who was a dear friend of Ralphie's. Pete Pirelli. Did you ever get to meet Pete Pirelli? People don't like him. I loved him to death. He was one of the first guys that headlined me, and he loved Ralphie. And that's how it went down. Friday was basically just a shock. And then Friday night was when it got worse. A little, when I started realizing what was going on, when Ari called and Josh Wolf called late night. And I had spoken to Josh that afternoon after it happened. He was upset. And next thing you know, fucking Sarah Tiana called, and I tried to butter her up and tell her, don't worry, I got that edible for you. That's what stopped her from crying. And then Saturday, you know, I had to do kid stuff, and every once in a while I would realize, for people who have experienced death before, and a lot of you have, you know, it's a magnitude of emotion, and then you go numb, and then time is the healer. You know, whatever in levels, you get better in levels, you know, and, but the number one thing is coming to grips with it. Like, my body and mind still haven't come. Because I wouldn't talk to him sometimes for 4 days of the shot. So my body's just, you know. He was supposed to come into L.A. last week. The plan was for him to come into L.A. last week. If you looked at the Comedy Store on Tuesday, he had a spot at the store Tuesday night.
Wow.
So we were going to try to do the podcast Wednesday, and then he was going to fly back because he was going to get the Comedian of the Year. Mm. So when I went, I didn't think about him coming in. I go, I assume he's doing a podcast Wednesday. So when I went to the store Tuesday night, you know, when you're at the store, you go down there, who wants to take a picture? You bump into somebody you haven't seen in a while.
Yeah.
Next thing you know, you get in your car and without knowing. You know, I got here at 6:30 today without my bag. I came all, you know, sometimes you have so much on your mind.
Absolutely.
And I got in the car and headed up Laurel Canyon. And the next thing you know, fucking, when I get to the house, I'm laying in bed with the sleep apnea mask on. I'm like, wait a second.
But I forget.
I didn't see Ralphie tonight. So the first thing Wednesday morning, I called just to make sure. I didn't know if he had the kids, you know, Tuesday. And then he went over or something. And he said no, that he didn't feel well. He had the pneumonia. But he had a different angle to him. I could always make him laugh. And on this day, I couldn't make him laugh. Something wasn't right. And I hung up on him. I didn't think nothing odd. I just thought maybe he'd be having a bad day.
Yeah.
And I came on and I told Lee that night. We had a podcast Wednesday night by ourselves. And I sat here and I told Lee that I didn't think Ralphie had much time. And that didn't have anything to do with the pneumonia.
Yeah.
Didn't have nothing to do with that. It had to do with a tone in your voice that I recognized. One day when I was a kid, I fucking was leaving the house. Getting ready to leave. You know, you're getting ready to leave and the phone rings and we had no caller ID in those days.
Yeah.
I went and I picked up the phone. It was my mom. And she goes, I'm here. I'm going to get something to eat and then I'm going to come home because I don't feel good. But I'll never forget, I left the house thinking,
you can feel it.
Her voice sounded weird. I didn't know then until years later that she died that night. Well, Ralphie had it wasn't a heart attack. It wasn't congestive heart failure. It wasn't, it's what the Chinese call you die of a broken heart.
Oh.
You die from the inside out. Sometimes so many things are going on in your life, and at one point, something just strikes you, and you ain't coming back from that. It's not a depression. It's a different level. It's the level that, I don't want to do this no more. That's a complete different level than depression.
Yeah.
The level when, you know why they found him? He missed radio. He didn't go to radio. Thursday, Friday morning.
Unbelievable.
So, you know, I know he's in a better spot. I know the last couple of years he's been living with a lot of pain, so now he's pain-free. You know, things happen in your life sometimes, especially during a divorce, that you can't believe are happening. You are not going to believe this is happening. And if your faith is fucked up and if things are going on wrong, it pushes past the boundary and you don't come back from that boundary. After my divorce, I had a hard time, guys. If it wasn't, this is a stupid thing, but comedy saved my life, guys. I'm telling Lee, Steve Simone, and the people at home. Comedy saved my life in a weird way.
Yeah.
In a weird fucking way, because the divorce killed me. The divorce was one thing.
Yeah.
The kids, my daughter, that whole thing in the beginning, I couldn't handle this, but it's not like I'm in a Liam Neeson movie and somebody took my kid.
Yeah.
It's the person's closest to you. That hurts from a different angle. I'm not saying anything bad about anybody, but I'm just saying during a divorce, when you have children involved and they start becoming a pawn in the divorce, it takes away from you. You know, he didn't want to come here anymore. He didn't want to read for TV shows. He was done. You know, the road sales, you could, if you look at his things, it's not like he tweeted his dates. He could care less if you showed his fucking shows, you know. Yeah. It was something, and I tried to go on the road with him about 2 years ago. I offered to go open for him and to walk in the daytime.
I remember that.
Remember that? I said, listen, I'll take the money cut. It's not about the paper. It's what... The amount of things I learned from watching Ralphie, you know, it doesn't take... I said this 1,000 times, you know, it doesn't take a fucking book or anything to learn about people, especially with comedy, you know, like... The amount of stuff I learned from Ralphie was, it was like going to fucking, what's that pasta place? What's the endless bowl?
Yeah, Olive Garden.
Olive Garden. That's what Ralphie was, my Olive Garden when it came to comedy. You would ask Ralphie anything about comedy. Ralphie looked like a big fat putz to the human eye. But when it came to stand-up comedy, he had clothing down. He had...
Genius.
Eye levels down.
Encyclopedia of knowledge.
You know, he wanted you to switch by the channel, so he wanted you to put on a yellow leather jacket. That's why he wore that craziness. You know, he was a genius at a different fucking level. And listen, a lot of comics didn't like him. He had a big finger pointed at him out of Houston that he was a joke thief. Listen, in the beginning, we all make mistakes in comedy. You know, I heard things 10 years ago, but I don't know about those specials.
Yeah.
Those specials are solid. The first three or four of them were fucking solid. I don't know. Bigger and Blacker and all that shit. That shit made me laugh. So that doesn't matter when you're in a casket. You want me to tell you what mattered? How he treated 200 of us.
Yeah.
How he treated...
Everybody he met.
Everybody.
200 of us.
That's the thing, Joey. I don't even... When I think of Ralphie, I know he was a brilliant comic, but I don't even think of that. I don't even think of Ralphie on stage.
No.
I think of, you could feel his warmth. He cared about people, and you could feel it. When he talked to you, he was there. You know what I mean? He wasn't one of those guys looking over your shoulder, somebody else coming in the room. Is somebody else more important to talk to? His heart was open when he communicated with you.
It's, like I was telling you guys before the show, I was here a couple months, and all of a sudden this chubby kid appeared, and everybody said he was fucking hilarious. And Mitzi Shaw put him on, and I could tell it was a hard time for him to walk. And I would talk to him. I didn't know who the fuck he was. He just had a southern twang to him. Mm-hmm. And I would talk to him. And one Thanksgiving, I got a call from Marilyn Martinez, God rest her soul. And she said Joey Medina was having a barbecue over at his house. Ralphie was cooking. And I go, who's the fucking kid Ralphie? And I get over there, and I walked, and I told Lee the story. I walked in, and there's this kid on a fucking futon. That's when futons were hot. He had broken the futon. And he had a big blanket on him, and he was jovial. And, you know, they didn't have much, but what they had, they shared it with you. You know, I had nothing at the time. I had fucking nothing. I was just a death merchant, whatever the fuck you call those things, living off comedy and the $15 at the store. And here I am at this house. I knew Joey Medina. I knew Alex Raimundo, who's the opener for Ron White. Yeah. Now I knew him, you know, and we would all talk and stuff, and I never forget leaving there going, this is fucking crazy. I don't even know these people.
Mm.
And I just was there for 5 hours and I had a blast.
Comedy.
And that fucking fat kid's a blast. And he smoked dope.
Yeah.
He was very pottish, and he had different types of weed and shit, and I was like, wow. And then he signed with a manager who had cancer. Okay, she was dying. After he signed with her, she was diagnosed with cancer. But I'm at the store. I'm snorting blow. Now, Stanhope is good friends with Ralphie. So everybody who went through the Stanhope route, like I did, you stayed with Stanhope for a while, then you blossomed out. Ralphie, I think, stayed with Stanhope for a while. Yes, because one day I got a call from Stanhope saying that he couldn't find Ralphie, that he came home and Ralphie was making out with his mother. And he yelled at him and Ralphie left embarrassed.
Was Stanhope's mother?
Yeah, she's like 60 at the time. So Ralphie calls me back. He's fucking lying. I don't make out with his mother. Bonnie Earmuffs, God rest her soul.
Oh my God.
She had fake tits from the 50s. Fucking hysterical. This is just so she lived. So Ralphie, Doug Stanhope had an apartment.
How old is Ralphie?
A baby. Doug Stanhope had an apartment. 25. Because I'm 45. So I'm 9 years his elder. So 98, I had to be 30-something. Yeah, he was a baby.
Yeah.
He was a baby. He was a baby. So he's on fire. He's a regular at the store. He's a regular at the improv. He walks into the Laugh Factory and bam! Not only do they make him a regular there, but they fucking, Jamie Masada signs him on the spot.
Wow.
He tells Jamie, well, you know, I'm a good old boy and I'm already with a manager. And Jamie goes, yeah, but she's dying of cancer.
Oh my God.
And Ralphie's like, yeah, but I got to finish out my commitment with her and stuff. He goes, I'll get back to you. This is just too much for me. So he walks, he comes to the comedy store, and it's a Sunday night. I'm hosting maybe, you know, there was nobody out on the patio.
Nothing.
And he's sitting there sad as fuck with his little chubby cheeks. You know, he's just a baby. I'm snorting blow. I'm a wild man.
Yeah.
And he comes up to me and goes, can I ask you a personal question? You've done this and you've done that. He tells me, the girl, you know, he's a Christian man, Ralphie.
Yeah.
And he looks me straight in the face and he goes, I signed with this manager and she's dying of cancer. I don't know how much time she's got left. I can't fire her. But Jamie Masada wants to sign me, and it's an opportunity of a lifetime. I go, he goes, what should I do, Joey? I looked at him and I go, listen, she's got one from the great one of Banana Peel. Send her a note and sign with Jamie Masada. He looked at me for a second, maybe 3 seconds, and then lost it. He lost it. He just started laughing his ass off. He said, that's the funniest thing I ever heard, Coco.
You know, Coco.
Coco.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, yeah, that was it.
That's exactly the same Coco, tone. That's exactly Coco. It. Oh.
That's the funniest thing I ever heard, Coco. Okay, so now I end up at his house fucking 4 nights a week drinking. Him and Jody Fertig and John Wesley had this fucking vodka, and they would bring up the fucking
Bloody
Mary mix from Houston.
I remember.
You remember that shit?
You used to tell. They would do a whole run to the
Houston, yeah. And get the bottles of that shit, and they get queso, and then we would sit there. This is way before. This was John was there already. Me, Jody, and Ralphie May would drink a bottle of vodka with that Bloody Mary mix. I'd be in the bathroom sneaking bumps. You know, he never judged me. He never really. It was nothing like that. It was nothing like that. It was just, he was just a regular guy. And then he asked me where I was from, and I would tell him Carmine about this before I told anybody anything.
Yeah.
Like, I never told anybody anything. Where you from, Jersey? Well, my town play football. That's it. Nobody knew nothing. And one night, he just asked me. And I just started telling him Georgie stories and Carmen Balzano stories and stories of me growing up in my mother's bar. So we left it at that.
Yeah.
Okay? He tells me one day, like a month later, he goes, Coco, one day I'm going to come up to this North Bergen. You know, whatever the fuck he says to me. I'm like, sure. He goes, I'm going to be in Jersey in August to send it. He goes, I'm bringing my car. I'm going to drive up to North Bergen to see if this shit's real.
Wow.
Okay. Something happens, bro. And I get a call to do Jersey, like that whole run I used to do, like Buffalo, And where am I? I'm in North Bergen. It's the summer of 99.
Wow.
And I had my pager. And sure enough, the pager goes off and it's Ralphie. And he's like, you're not going to believe this. I'm on 48th Street and Kennedy Boulevard, headed up to Ashways on 76. You know, he's telling me all this. And I'm like, listen, before you go to Ashways, pull over on 69th Street. I'll be on the corner. What are you talking about? I said, I'm in town.
Wow.
I could hear that. He's like, I'll be right there. And also,
divine intervention.
He came right to Georgie's house. He picked me up. I introduced him to Georgie. This is way before Last Comic Standing.
Yeah.
This is a while before Comic Standing. And I took him to a place called Hashway's Deli, where I had grown up on. Everybody has their personal deli. Yeah. This was my deli. And I was very proud of the roast beef on the rye. I would put it up against anybody, and I also put up the rice pudding up against anybody.
Gotcha.
Like, that's what they were known for, the roast beef and the rice pudding. And if I brag about it, it's because...
it's real.
You're going to go blind when you eat it.
Yes.
And I took him to Hashway's. He fucking had the roast beef. You know, he's 600 pounds, dog. That's a different patois. He's from Houston. I'm taking him to North Bergen. I'm taking him to Beeman.
What did he think?
His head blew up. He became friends with the Hashways, and then it got to the point that every time he'd be in the area, he'd just go to Hashways and pick up a gallon of fucking rice pudding.
Wow.
They give him a container of whipped cream.
That's great.
They give him a can of whipped cream, and they give him a little thing of cinnamon. That's how he liked it. That's the type of guy Ralphie was. Then one day, I get a call from Veneri, the kid I grew up with, who's the assemblyman, and he goes, Die, I just got a fucking... some big fat guy came in here yelling about North Bergen rules and shit. He says his name is Ralphie May. He's right outside. I go, yeah, bro, that's family.
Yeah.
I go, you're done. You're just meeting family. But I introduced him to George. I was going to have George called in tonight, but George is working at New York Comic Con. You know, and then their relationship, they're at giant games.
Yeah.
That's the type of guy Ralphie was.
He made friends.
If he was my brother, Ralphie took care of him.
Yeah.
Never mind. This went on while he was... broke. I'll never forget 9/11. We were at Ralphie's house. He made a gumbo. Wow. On 9/11 that night, he made a gumbo for me, Jay Moore, Jody, a bunch of people over there. Mike Faverman.
Wow.
9/11 gumbo.
9/11 gumbo. Broke. Broke. He'd give you the last fucking dollar off his shirt.
Yeah.
I still remember a night going over there. I had never heard of this guy's. I had never seen it before. I am fucked up. In those days, I lived in my car. It was between my car and Ralphie's apartment. And I would park the car at night and pull the seat back on Vista between El Compadre and between Vista and whatever that street was. El Compadre's on Sunset.
Gardner.
Sunset and Gardner. I would park 50 yards from Josh Wolf's apartment. I had a blanket. I would, whatever coke I had left over, I would polish it off out there, and then I'd pop the seat back, I'd put the air conditioner on, and I'd wait till I got horny, and I'd jerk off two or three times in the car. People would be walking their dog past me at 4 a.m, I'd be in the car pulling my yanker. And then I'd come in the blanket and walk to Ralphie's house. And it must have been 4 a.m, because I would never go to Ralphie's coked up. I would always wait to come down, or at least look like. He would always leave the door open for me just to slip in at night. And he'd put a pillow on the floor. And that's exactly what I would do. I'd come in with that cummy blanket, and I'd throw it over me with the pillow, and I'd sleep right there, bro. No shame. I was doing it for comedy, and he was the guy that was helping me. But one night, I'm coming over there, and I come around the bend, and I hear voices, and I see smoke. Like, there's a little fire. I turn in, and it's him, Jay Moore, Teddy, Gavin Boyd. There must have been 10 motherfuckers back there at 5 a.m, deep frying a turkey.
It's great.
I'd never heard of that, Lee. All right? When he pulled that turkey out an hour later and let it sit, Now it's daylight. They're getting beers and shit. I don't know if nobody was doing blow. This was not a cocaine crowd.
Yeah.
It was Ralphie was cooking a turkey.
It's probably delicious.
It was delicious. I never tasted anything like that. That's the first time. Then after that, I bugged them. For years to make that fucking thing. Let's do it again. That was one of the best mornings. You know, listen, man, I'm doing comedy now and everything's good and I have a family. But I told you guys, I would give my finger to to go back to that life for a week with him in that apartment, because it was real camaraderie, and he had no reason to love me, and I had no reason to love him.
Before the money, before the career,
this is anything,
just love.
That's just all love. It was based on
that's
love.
That's all we need.
And he had people over there. He listen. He brought John Wesling up. He brought Jody Fertig up. He brought Celine up. You know, I mean, this was a clique from Houston that was just, and he introduced them to me. Until today, they're my family. I mean, we lost Celine earlier this year, and Jody's doing her thing, and Gentry's doing her thing, and, you know, but I still talk to Stacy. That's throughout this whole thing, that's who's been there for me. You know, I'm getting all my information, basically, from there, and I feel bad for her, you know. I might have to hire her. Just out of what Ralphie did
respect,
for me, because she's out of a job, you know, and Ralphie's assistant, who just had a baby, and he just lost his job with Ralphie and the insurance Ralphie was providing for him. So there's a lot of, and then you got to think about the two children, you know, and what's going on there. And, you know, it's one of those situations where I have a duty, you know. I have a duty to check up on him and talk to him and talk to the little boy. He's going to go through hell now.
Yeah.
I know what a young man goes through when you lose your father, you know, especially when he was such a big figure and he meant so much to you.
Yeah.
So, it's the effect that a death has, because he had two families. He really was a gangster. He really, really, really was a gangster. He had his home family.
And his comedy family.
And his comedy family. And I got to tell you, man, you spoke to Ari?
I left him a message. Okay. It went straight to voicemail.
Yeah, he didn't sound too good. A lot of people ain't sounding too fucking good.
He was so good to so many people, that's why. You know, he was such a good person. He cared.
He
we live
was.
In a world where a lot of people don't care.
No, they don't give a fuck. I still remember having my surgery to get the fat ball out. And I got the stitches in there and shit. And I got a fucking call upstairs. I didn't even have a cell phone. He called like the house phone. He's like, hey, man, I'm downstairs. I'm like, dog, I just had surgery. He goes, I know, that's why I got to see you. And I went downstairs and he handed me a stack of cash and a rubber band. And he goes, here, so you don't have to worry about your surgery and you can relax. It was $1,000. I took it upstairs. I just gave it to my wife. I go, you're not going to believe this. Look at this. We needed the money like now, like yesterday.
Immediately.
And I go, you're not going to believe just what happened. An angel just came to the fucking
door. Exactly what it was.
You know, there was a time where I got a flat tire. He called me and wanted me to call. What was the sushi place he went to? Remember, he went to the most expensive. He went to a sushi place in Hollywood, guys.
Nobu or something? Is that?
No. This is on Beverly. Off La Cienega. Like, it's just movie stars. Like, the last... Like, I remember him calling me going, I'm sitting 2 feet from Clint Eastwood.
Wow.
Like, when you go in there, it's a metal detector, the whole fucking deal. When he first hit, when he got his $150,000 from Vegas, he took me there. And by that time, he had gone there already 3 times. He was just throwing money at the Japanese waiters and shit. No conveyor belt, Lee. This is straight up gangster, okay? And like one time I went in there, the chick from Marvel was in there. The chick that was in Rounders, she played the chick at the pool hall, real hot.
I don't remember.
Did you ever watch Rounders, Lee?
No.
That day you never watched it, see? But I'm sure you watched some fucking stupid fucking movie or something. Anyway, that chick is hot now. The chick from Rounders, the long-legged brunette. She's you'd see her. If you see her, she played. I saw her in there with Ralphie one day. Every time I went in there, I didn't see movie stars. I saw movie stars.
Yeah, the real deal.
Like they were real deal. Like he seen Clint Eastwood. I think as I was walking in one day, Tom Hanks was walking out. It's that type of stuff.
Yeah. So I don't even know this place. You know what I mean? Like normal people.
Okay,
don't even
just
know.
Yeah. You go to you
it's
go
different
to
world. Different.
You're on La Cienega and you make a left on Beverly, and it's right there. It's like a little Japanese house. And that's why you can't tell. It looks like a little Japanese house.
Yeah.
They got like a little Japanese valet. He takes the car and takes it underground. Nobody. Like they nobody. And you walk in there and he would walk in and go and they would go, Namaste. What are they?
Yeah, yeah.
What are they?
Whatever. Kukaba.
Is it Boss Sushi?
I don't know. I wouldn't know the name of it even if you told me. he would walk in and they would be yelling all that shit at him, and he'd go, "Must be the money." He would just yell, "Must be the money."
Oh, that's hysterical.
And I would die of fucking laughter. When he first hit, guys, in 2005, let's just say, no, in 2004, he was already banging.
Yeah. Right?
He was already banging.
I remember being on the road with Paulie. We went to a little club in Chattanooga called the Comedy Catch. And it was right after Ralphie had done Last Comic Standing. And they told me that he sold out everything. They added shows, and there were still lines down the block. And that was like 2003, 2004.
Yes, yes.
Right after Last
Comic Standing. Because I couldn't do Houston with him because I was doing Spider-Man 2. And then something happened. What the fuck happened? Something happened with him. And he got me a room in New York. Like, he was just fucking hooking ball. When I got the Longest Yard, I got a weekend or somewhere. I got a weekend in Rascals, Jersey City.
Yeah.
And Ralphie called me. He goes, "Dog, where are you staying?" I go, he goes, no. I'm headlining Caroline's. I got a room for a feature. I got an extra room. Stay in the extra room. So I stayed with him. And that was the time I went up there. I got there at 3 o'clock. He got there. And I got there like at 4. He was there at 3 o'clock. I go, "What are you doing?" He goes, "Nothing. I'm in the room waiting on you. Come on over. Let's order some food." I go over there. I open the fucking door. And he's got a bag of weed in front of him. He's been smoking for 20 minutes. And there's candy wrappers everywhere. And that thing they leave at the hotel, you know, like when you go in there, they charge you $22 for a chocolate bar.
Yeah.
And M&M's, a condom. Yeah. He had fucked it all up. Like the almonds, the fucking chocolate covered. We were howling. I go, "Ralphie, what the fuck?" Oh, you know.
Coco.
You know. It was a nonstop. He helped me so much. You know, like, this is, to normal people, people must be listening to me going, "Joey sounds too calm for losing something of this magnitude," because I have not digested it.
Right.
I've lost so many people that it still doesn't digest with me.
I lost a buddy at the beginning of the summer. Yeah. He's still alive in my brain.
Yeah, this and is one night when I'm coming home, I'm going to forget, and I'm going to press this fucking number on my phone, guys, and that's when I'm going to remember. And that's when it's all going to come to me that I haven't heard his voice, that he hasn't come on the podcast, that I'll never see him again.
You will in heaven. I totally believe that.
For sure. Heaven, Jack.
Oh, come on.
I ain't going to fucking heaven. Please. They're going to put me in purgatory for a few thousand years.
He's trusting his mercy.
Trust. Yeah. No, he's not going to take me right. He's not going to shit me right up there right away. I got to play a fucking game. I got to go to Israel and help the fucking slaves for 2,000 years and shit. It
doesn't work.
But you don't get, in fact, they don't let fat people in heaven. You got to be like 180 or above. They don't want no problems if you get to heaven. Seattle, they put you, they send you to a Christian fat camp.
There's a weight limit in heaven.
Steve Simone, what's going on with you, player?
This one, I don't. It's been a rough week, Joey. I'm going
to
be honest.
No,
with
I
you.
Know, I know.
I try not to be this person, you know, but I'm just trying to focus on all the joy Ralphie brought into the world.
Yeah, that's why I haven't.
You know, like legitimately, and thank God I wasn't closer to him. But it always made me feel good whenever we hung out. You know, he just had that energy where just made me feel good. Like, I remember him pulling into the Comedy Store last year, and he had like a convertible BMW, some kind of sick car. And it was just like, it kind of reminded me a little bit of like when Rodney Dangerfield showed up at the country club in Caddyshack, like, yeah. "Oh, Ralphie's here." And he's like, "Bam, bam, 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 bam." You know what I mean? You know what I mean? And he's like handing out cash to the parking lot guys, and it was like, "Oh, the party's here." And then just the young guys going, "Stevie Simone, how you doing, player?" And then me and Ralphie are in the middle of the parking lot. And then all the young door guys are like, "Oh, shit, Simone knows Ralphie May." And I'm like, "Yeah, how long have you?" And I'm like, "I've known Ralphie since I started comedy." And I would totally earlier today, just he had this way of just encouraging you, you know? Like, I remember just he was always supportive of younger comics. And always. The bigger his star got, the more people he started to influence.
Always, yeah. Always.
And we would talk, because he was really not happy the last couple of years. And my phone would ring sometimes at odd hours. And I would just get on the phone and talk to him. And I firmly believe, I'm not telling anybody else what to believe, but I think I'm praying that he has the peace now that he was searching for the last couple of years, you know? And I believe it. Like in my heart, it makes me feel good. I know he's in a better place.
All I know is one thing, man. I know one thing for sure, guys, that at an early age I had a sadness in my heart, but the fucking people around me made me hobble with laughter. There is nothing like somebody making you fucking die of laughter, okay?
Yeah, it's the best feeling in life.
Now, with Ralphie May, it wasn't as much that he made me die of laughter as how much he would leave himself open to a guy like me, okay? Like,
Coco.
Like, when you meet me, do me a favor. If you like me, and time, tell me everything about you. Don't make me have to find something out on this slide. Like, one night I was here, one night, and fucking me and Lee were talking, and Lee was mad high. I hadn't seen Lee that high in a long time. And he got pale on me. Pale. I mean, then I got scared. I thought he was quitting, or he's going to Boston to be with his mother. You know, it was like something came over him, and he told me the deepest, darkest secret of his soul. And he was like, you know, I hope we're cool. And I go, Lee, you know, you're always my brother. I don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
But Lee got to know me so good. He's like, I'm going to tell Joey before Joey finds out. I'm going to tell him that, you know, I used to be a tranny before. I'm just teasing you. I'm just teasing you. But he never told me a certain, when we first hung out together for years, he never fucking told me that about spellbindness.
Okay.
When comedy got really popular in the 90s, mm-hmm. there was the Laugh Stop, the Laugh Spot, the Comedy Showcase. There was everything but an improv in Houston.
In Houston, yeah.
But the club was Spellbinders. If you ever went to the Houston Improv 10 years ago when it first opened,
yep.
it was the old Spellbinders.
Okay.
Ralphie was banned from Spellbinders because he fell to the stage and sued the club, all right? Now, her name was either Kim Carnes or Lynn Carnes or something. Somebody sang a song with Kim Carnes.
Oh, yeah.
So this lady was Lynn Carnes.
Voices carry or right, whatever.
So Lynn Carnes was the lady who booked the room. So when I found this information out, I didn't bust his balls. You know me, dog. I'm with him. We're getting high. And I, you know, and all of a sudden I look at him one day. Like, listen. I just put a tape in. You know, I worked them over. Like, listen, I just put a tape in over it. Spellbinders. Can you recommend me?
You're baiting the
hook. Oh, yeah. You know, like, I would fuck with him that way. You know what I'm saying?
The way you said it, did he know that you knew?
No. He didn't know I knew.
So now he's like, he's got to tell so now to you.
So it's me and him, and he had to tell me why he couldn't fucking, and he started right off with, let me tell you what happened. The stage was fucked up. You know what I'm saying? I went up there and my foot went through it and I could never walk the same. So I sued. So anytime we get in a squeaky position, like we'd be walking upstairs and the stairs would go, I go, Rafi, stop. It's like spellbinding the stairs. Fuck you, Coco. Fuck you, Coco. You mess with a man's emotions, Coco. I sued him. I walk with a limp because of the spell of that dirty bitch. Like, I always tormented him. Nobody remembers who got me out of the biggest pinch ever in this town. Who got me out of the biggest pinch? I was going to get pinched for a sexual, lewd act in public.
Oh, my God.
That means I would have had to register as a sex offender in 22,000 states. I can't even go to Puerto Rico and put a bikini on and look for survivors. You know what I'm saying? Even if I go to Puerto Rico looking for survivors with a bikini on, I'd go to jail. So he fucking, and I didn't do nothing. I ate some chick's pussy at the fucking comedy club. Remember that comedy club that fucking Jay Davies ran? the way Dane Cook became a star.
Dublin's.
I ate some chick's pussy and went with a Coke rock, and I took the eight ball.
You're describing it. So I'll be this chick's pussy in Dublin's.
You never knew that?
Big deal. No.
Me, I go to Dublin's with Rogan and Willie Barsena.
Oh, my God.
I go to dinner with Rogan to meet Willie Barsena. This is the crew from fucking hell.
What year is this?
Dude, oh, this had to be the brink of 99, 2000, maybe March, because I started dating my wife 2 months after that, and it was really awkward. Till this day, don't mention that bar around my wife, Double.
Never.
She has a fucking heart attack, because Jay Davies put it up on his website. And my wife...
He put your business up on his website?
Oh, mine and Holtzman, and my wife called me fucking upset, so I had to call him. So the legend to the story is basically this. I show up with Rogan and Willie. We go to the Dublin. We all have a spot. Obviously, Jay Davis is an asshole. He puts Willie up, who just did 22 Tonight shows. He puts Rogan up, who's starting to get heat. And then he puts my fat ass in there, and I just eat a bag of dicks. But the place is so packed, you can't even get out of there. I mean,
yep.
It's tough to even describe to people what this place was in L.A. on a Tuesday night. And at the Comedy Store... It was African-American night. It was Joe Torre night.
Oh, yeah.
So there was no white acts. And you would call in for spots, but if they gave you a spot on a Tuesday, you were pissed if you were white.
Well, sometimes there was no audience.
There was no parking. There was eight people, and there was no parking. All the hot comedy was at the Dublin. If you wanted to get a piece of ass, it was at the Dublin. You want to do blow, it was at the Dublin. You want to get an agent, you better be at the Dublin.
Yeah. There's nothing like it now.
It was that type of place, people. There's nothing like it. Tuesday night, if you weren't at the Dublin hanging out, you weren't dick.
Yeah.
You weren't dick. I wasn't a hangout type of guy, but Rogan got me a spot. He goes, you want to do a spot? I'll talk to Jay Davis. Don't want to give me a spot. Yeah. Next thing you know, I'm following everybody. And Alonzo Bowden.
Wow.
Alonzo Bowden was
would
kill that room. I go up there, I eat a bag of shit. I get off stage. I can't even walk out in front of the crowd. Not from the embarrassment, but just from the fucking, it was too crowded.
Yeah, couldn't get
so I had to sit next to Alonzo Bowden and this dude with long hair who always had a bunch of women with him. He ran the club next to the fucking club I was at.
Okay.
Years earlier, he ran the club with Ahmed and the big star, his fucking girlfriend, his ex-girlfriend.
Vince Vaughn's
ex-girlfriend.
Wow.
So I'm at this club. I hit the downstairs. There's this girl. I start talking to her. I got that animal magnetism. She tells me she got some tutsuruts. I got nothing. I got maybe $8 in my pocket. I can't even get a drink because I can't pay a tip. I take her downstairs. We do a couple blasts. We go to the freezer room. I put her on a keg. I ask her right out, anybody ever do a blast of coke off your little pussy and lick it? No, nobody's ever done that. Well, take that bikini on. Let's put that little monkey to work. She went for the whole thing. I put a coke right into monkey. I ate it. I had my cock out whacking off. The whole fucking thing was horrible.
Yeah.
But they had us on camera. And all of a sudden, that little Hindu door buff steroid guy opened up the door with three big black guys. And they're like, get out. I put the coke in my sock and shit. They took me upstairs. I wouldn't get rid of that coke. I'm old school. I'll hold on to this motherfucker. There's got to be a way. They didn't handcuff me.
So it was just security. They didn't call the cops.
It was just security. They called the cops. Oh. The cops were on their way. They had me on tape. And the next thing you know, the girl's crying. The other girl she's with is crying. The guy with the long hair who thought he was Johnny Macho buying drinks. Here I am eating his girlfriend's asshole in the freezer. He's sitting there red in the face staring me down. And I'm like, what do you want me to do, guys? Am I thrown out of here? Can I leave? And they're like, no, we call the cops. We're going to press charges for summons and shit. You know, I can't go through this shit. There's going to be some sexual shit. But I look up, and it was Miyagi across the street.
Yep.
It was all-you-can-eat sushi if you did a set.
Yep.
So guess who's at all-you-can-eat sushi? Ralphie May. I look up, and I see Ralphie walking towards me, waddling across Sunset Boulevard. And when he crossed, he goes, what's going on, Coco? I go, listen, go get your car. Go get your car. And he's like, why? I go, go get your car. They just call the cops. Why? I go, I can't explain. Just go get your fucking car, Ralphie. Also, Willie Barsett and Rogan come out. And they go, what's going on? I go, they call the cops. Rogan peeled off a $100 bill. He goes, call me from jail. You got my number. And I'll go down there with Willie.
Wow.
Willie goes, call his bail bonds. And all of a sudden, I go, all right. And they're like, what happened? I go, I don't know. We're eating a pussy. And they saw me on tape. So this girl's going to say something. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. They got the tape. Nothing happened. I just ate a monkey. You could see her pulling off her own panties, the whole thing.
Yeah.
And the next thing you know, I see the Forerunner.
Ralphie.
Ralphie had the red Forerunner with the silver bottom. And the fucking security guard was trying to talk to the girl. And the other guy was just amazed. It was Rogan from Fear Factor or something. He was amazed with Rogan.
News radio, whatever.
And I'm right there. The truck is right there. And I fucking look. I look. I get right in the fucking truck. I close the door. I go, go, Ralphie. Ralphie goes right around, stays right on Sunset. And the next thing you know, we're on fucking Sunset and Crescent Heights, which is Sunset and Laurel Canyon. I go, Ralphie, just in case they're following us, go past and hook that fucking right down. We were right there. I went to where Ralphie was living, where I was living.
Martel.
It was. It had to be 9 o'clock at night. I ate. I licked some pussy, and I came home with an eight ball and a dollar bill. And it was Ralphie who took me out of that mess.
Wow. No repercussions. Nothing.
Nothing. I was just banned from the club for life. And then Brian Holtzman got banned a year later for throwing a chair. And that was it. It was me and him that were banned.
Wow. I kind of remember the Holtzman story. I didn't start hanging at the store to 2001, really.
But you were there with Ralphie. Listen, dog, I was only at the store 4 years before you. It's not like I was there 10 years.
Right.
I got there.
Well, I remember when I got there.
February 97.
Ralphie was already starting to just set up shop at the Laugh Factory.
Yeah, he was killing him.
Yeah, he was killing him at the Laugh Factory.
People were coming to see him. People wanted it. It was amazing, guys.
And then I remember, because I loved Ralphie right away. And you remember the Big Daddy guys?
Yes, they gave us the clothing.
Yes, and I remember going, all right, I got another guy for you.
Was it your connection?
Yeah.
Oh, it was your connection.
I got you, then Ralphie, then Fat James.
Wow.
And I remember that.
That goes back.
Yep. And I remember Ralphie was just so cool.
Steve Simone on this, because out of all the guys I know that have love, Steve has real love. I could tell when you called me the other day and you said you just want to talk. And you knew I wanted to talk.
Yeah.
Because this is how you remember all this shit. Here's how you remember what you've done with the guy. Another time, I see him at the store. I got a late set. I got a package in my pocket. I got 40 or 50 bucks. He's telling me he already did his set. I go, you know what? I don't give a fuck about doing my set here. You going home, Ralph? He goes, yeah, I'm going to go home, smoke some play, smoke some reefer. You know what? I'm coming with you. We drive home. We drive to Sunset and Gardner.
Mm-hmm.
We park the car. All right. We're talking. We're talking the whole way home. Baba boom, baba beam. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. Right? We pull over, he stops the car, we're still talking. You know, you've been in a conversation, you're still talking?
It's the best.
The next thing you know, I open up my car door, I get out of the fucking car, we're still talking as I get out of the car.
Yeah.
Now I get out of the car, I slam the car door, I take three steps, I'm still talking. I start walking towards Ralphie's house, I'm still talking. I turn around, no fucking Ralphie.
Where was he?
I look over, Ralphie fell, and he's on Gardner, and he's like, help, help me, right? So now, I reach over, and I try to pick him up with one hand. That's not going to work, right?
Yeah.
So I got to get his hand and get his leather jacket.
Yep.
As I'm pulling him up, some lady by the fire department goes, leave him alone, I'm calling the police. I go, Ralphie, you got to get up, because they think I'm going to be mugging you. He's like, I can't get up. Come on, I slipped on the plate. There was no plate there. He just fell. This was his equilibrium was off. So I'm picking him up, picking him up, picking him up, picking him up. I mean, the lady's like, leave him alone. Call the police. Call the police. I'm like, Ralphie, get up. They're calling the fucking cops on us, you fuck.
Oh, my God.
I walk in his apartment one day in the afternoon. I'm happy to see him. He's back there. And he's got a screen up and a curtain. And like another screen, okay? He's got no shirt on. And I walk in and he gives me the lips over the lips. I go, what's going on? He goes, and all of a sudden, what's the guy's name? What's the pretty boy's name? I did not know this. I did not know this. What's the real pretty guy in Hollywood? Not Leonardo DiCaprio, but the other guy with the blonde hair.
Brad Pitt?
No.
Fabio?
No. The blonde hair, short. He did the movie with about the fucking black people. He played the attorney. Well, that's how his career got started. A Time to Kill. Good looking guy, smokes reefer.
Is that Matthew McConaughey?
Yes, Matthew McConaughey. So I walk into Ralphie's. I don't know dick about dick people, okay? I'm just a. It's got to be 19. It's got to be 2001. I was the only person who was allowed in that house when Ralphie didn't have a shirt on. Like, that's how much that's he trusted
love.
Me at
yeah,
the time.
That's love.
I walk in. Ralphie kind of covers up. He forgot he left the door open. And he's like, shh. And I go, what's the matter? And he goes, shh. And all of a sudden, he's like, Matthew McConaughey, your movie sucked dick. And all of a sudden, he would go like this. And all of a sudden, you hear, fuck you. And he, Matthew McConaughey, I went to see your last movie. You owe me $8.50. And Matthew McConaughey and him were having this verbal dialogue that I knew nothing about until that moment.
Where the hell was Matthew McConaughey?
Matthew McConaughey had a garage. If you go behind 1440, okay, if you're driving towards Sunset from Fountain,
yep.
And you're on Gardner, right before you hit Sunset, there's an El Compadre parking lot.
Yep.
And you can make a right in there. You went too far. About 11 yards before that, before you get to Ralphie's building, if you hook the right,
yep.
There's a string of apartment buildings. Parking for those apartment buildings are back there. But there's some people who rent their garages. A friend of his rented his garage to Matthew McConaughey.
Oh, that's great.
And Matthew McConaughey was working on a car back there. And he would go back there in the afternoons with no shirt on, with a hat. And Ralphie would spend his fucking day
torturing him. Oh, how great's Ralphie.
Matthew McConaughey, your movie sucked. Yeah, fuck you.
Like an 11-year-old.
And then, here's the funny thing. Like, I hung out with him, and I did not know this, and all of a sudden they blew the whistle on him. Like, this had been going on for 90 days. And the funny thing was, everybody else in the building was in on it. Gavin was in on it. Fucking somebody else. There was somebody else in the building who said, it is one of the funniest things to listen to. He goes, I was sleeping one day, and I woke up to those two going off. And he goes, I thought it was Ralphie having a conversation with somebody else from the South. Oh, he goes, it was so Matthew funny. McConaughey. He goes, when I looked out the window, because those apartments don't have air conditioning. So your window's always got to be open.
Oh, that's so funny. Did they ever become friends?
No.
Till this day, Matthew McConaughey, he goes back there, and he probably looks back there and see if somebody's going to yell at him.
Why would Matthew McConaughey put up with that?
It's so funny.
Now, it was dark. So, like I told you guys, I went back there one day. After this went on, it baffled me. Like, I'm a fucking, you know what I'm saying? Like, you're arguing with Matthew McConaughey.
With a movie star around town.
Matthew McConaughey. Like, he would sing songs.
Torturing him.
So.
So good.
Oh, my God.
So.
Did Matthew McConaughey ever confront him and really, like?
No! Matthew McConaughey finally did something. Like, he did something.
Oh, my God.
I can't remember what he did. Like, he snapped one day. And he's like, come out, you fucking pussy. He finally confronted the building.
He says,
now, it was three floors. But how Ralphie was doing it, it sounded like it came from the top floor.
So he's looking in the wrong window?
Something. Ralphie was on the first floor right in front of him. But the way Ralphie had it padded and the whole system, Ralphie worked.
Throwing his voice like Jeff Dunham.
It was, and I remember going back there one day, and just because there's a lot of times we would sit and smoke dope. Like, a lot of times, it was such a popular area. Right now, at the top of my tongue, I forget who lived there then. But you were always bumping into comics in that area.
Yeah, it was like it was almost like being on a college campus.
And we would sit on that wall. Plus, the karate teacher, who I loved the shit out of, had a car back there, and he would work on it. And one day he asked me, he goes, Fucking Matthew McConaughey brought his car to the wrong neighborhood. They fucking hate him here. And I'm howling. I go, what are you? And I'm trying to control myself. And I go, what are you talking about? And he goes, boy, he tries to fix his cars back there. And there's somebody in that building who fucking tortures him.
Oh, it's so good.
He goes, and one day, two or three people got in on it. And that's what happened. Like, Gavin would get on it and shit. And
were he doing every day that he was there, too?
Every time. If Matt, if listen to me. If Ralphie had a meeting and he was about to leave and he looked out the window and he see Matthew McConaughey jacking up his car, the meeting would be canceled. He'd booby trap his window and he'd just start yelling from the top of his
That's so
I wish he'd recorded it.
Oh my
God. Oh my God. That was like a Jerky Boys CD that you could buy. Ralphie just hammering Matthew McConaughey's balls.
You have. It was, you know, and like I said to you guys, at this time I was walking around with nothing. I would go to his house at night and drink his vodka and fill the bottles back up with water.
That's a nice guess.
Oh my God. I would do the worst things. I loved him like a motherfucker. He would make me laugh my ass off with that type of shit. Like, you know, the best was, I'm in El Paso, Texas. I'm minding my own fucking business. And the phone rings at the condo. Bling, hello. Coco. It's Ralphie May. I'm coming right now. Like, what are you talking about right now? He goes, I'm coming from Houston. It's your birthday and it's my birthday. Mm. His birthday was February 17th. Mine was the 19th. So he goes, come down to Arby's. Meet me at Arby's. That's where you pull in and we'll go do some shit.
Yeah, birthday stuff.
Because the condo had moved. There was an old condo in El Paso. Now we had moved.
Was this at Bart Reed's Club?
Bart Reed's Club. Okay. It was on the west side, whatever.
Oh, yeah.
So the old condo was down the corner from Taco Cabana.
Oh, I love Taco Cabana.
Wake up in the morning, go right to Taco Cabana like a motherfucker.
Texas is.
Lee Syatt, we're going back to Austin. Austin. Going back to Austin. Yo, I don't think so. Going back to Austin. Austin. Going back to Austin. Yo, I don't think so. Going back to Austin. Getting some shrimp. I'm going back to Austin. I'm shrimp. Getting that fucking thing. Going to Chewy's. Get some Cuban food. Hang out with what's his name? Bobby and Sharon, too. Going back to Austin. Austin. Going back to Austin. I don't think so. Anyway, sorry, I got all fucking excited.
So it's your birthday.
So it's my birthday. Ralphie shows up. It's me, Noe Gonzalez.
Oh, I love Noe.
Maybe John Wessling. Maybe not. It was that long President's Day. So Bart Reed said, if you need to stay in the condo till Tuesday, she's not going to clean it. Who cares? So I had no reason to come back to L.A. Everything, and I was homeless.
Yeah.
So any day I didn't have to come back to L.A. It was fine. They offered to drive back with me. I couldn't do that 24-hour drive. That was brutal. Ugh. I already had a fucking plane ticket, so I was like, nah. So that Sunday we hung out, and then that Monday we woke up. Everybody stayed at the condo, which was nice. And we went somewhere, and then we went to the movies. We went to see Payback with Mel Gibson. Good movie. 2099.
What am I thinking? Was Denzel Washington in that movie?
No. This is 1997. Kick it, Lee. You remember that movie, Lee?
I don't think so.
No. Why would you? You were too busy playing fucking horoscope movies and shit.
Horoscope.
Payback. Mel Gibson.
I was not.
You've never seen this. Put a scene on from fucking this guy's great scene.
1999.
He was brilliant. We went to some movie theater to see this.
In 97 or which one?
99.
Payback.
Mel Gibson, Maria Bello.
Yeah. Tremendous. Fucking tremendous. Kind of black and whitey-ish. Kind of. It was shot differently. Brilliant. You know, like we were talking about before. Mel Gibson was fucking brilliant up to one point.
Yeah.
So we go into this movie. We ate somewhere. Like, we were in El Paso, so I'm just assuming we ate some Mexican that was good. And we go into this movie. And it's all of us, and we've got the whole row invaded. You know, give or take, me, Ralphie, Jody Furtick, Noe Gonzalez, there had to be eight of us. Gotcha. I can't remember who else was there. I think it was Carlos Mencia weekend. And we were all openers, and we all went together. And there's a silent part in the fucking movie. And I rip a fart that ricochets off the chair and goes out into the stratosphere. And the whole movie looks at Ralphie because he's the fattest dude in the movie theater. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, Ralphie, man. He's like, fuck you. Fuck you, Coco. I can't believe you blame me. And another time, again, him and I were dirt poor. And we decided with coupons. We had everything at that time.
Isn't it crazy?
Crazy. No dough.
We all think money's the answer.
No,
but you
no,
look at
no,
the
no,
happiest
no,
times
no,
of your life, we had nothing.
Nothing. He's yelling at Matthew McConaughey. He's just making the biggest
That's
movie.
More fun than going to Fiji.
Scroll that. Scroll
That's
that for a second.
As funny as it gets.
I bet Matthew McConaughey still hates that guy.
Hold on for a second. Yeah, put the trailer on. This has James Coburn in it. This is a... No, no, no. Go back for a second. Go back, go back. Go scroll down. Right there.
This one?
Yeah. Watch this scene. Kick this lot. Look who it is. This is like her first big thing. Look how hot she was.
My 70 grand. I want it.
I don't have it right now.
Where is it?
Well, I gave all... $130,000 to the outfit. I gave it all to them.
Well, tell them you gave them money that doesn't belong to you and get it back.
Carter, I can't do that. I mean, you don't know these guys. You're going to kill me whether I get the money or not.
Look how good Lucy
right,
Lewis.
I'll get
She's getting
money.
Turned on. Look at her.
Give me a few days, all right?
Noon. Tomorrow. Say it.
Hey, yeah, this may sound crazy, Porter, but no hard feelings, huh? I did what I had to do. You can appreciate that.
Yeah, I appreciate that. You.
No, don't. Please, allow me.
Oh, Jesus.
Look at her, she's giggling and shit. She loves all this shit.
Oh my god.
Let it work.
Oh.
That's why you pay these chicks to come over and do this to you.
Me love you, baby. Me love you.
Oh.
Time.
What the hell is this joke?
Look at her ass. Look at her little Chinese. Look at her. She comes back with a whip now. Oh, this is tremendous.
Oh, tremendous.
You wouldn't give a Chinese girl 500 to beat your face and suck your ass off.
For those listening, she just stepped on his balls and squished it out like a cigarette.
Okay. It's tremendous. That's why you fucking pay him the nickel.
No, we don't.
Who else is going to step on your balls and smack you in the face like that?
I don't want anyone to do that.
You don't know what type of party you're missing.
Tell me you've had someone kick you in the balls, Joey.
Listen, I had a chick smack me in the face a couple of times and tell me to go fuck my mother. It was tremendous. You come like a fucking savage, understand me? You just can't stop coming. You get flashbacks of mom, the whole fucking thing. You know what I'm saying?
You can't stop.
You go back to the womb and shit. Where's Tony Bennett?
I don't know.
Tony Bennett for fucking Ralphie made another one. You're going to sit there like a mamalooka to yank.
Give me one second.
I love you, cocksuckers. What are we talking about? Oh, then we went to the...
Oh, my
movies and you farted and everybody blamed Ralphie.
That was that time where I goes, Ralphie, and he goes, stop, Coco. And then about a year later, we went to Universal City up here in fucking whatever it is, and we bought M&M's. So I start. Hold on. Put the clock on. So I start throwing M&M's, right?
Oh no!
At who?
At whoever. We're in the second level, right? Now we just.
They're in the movie theater.
We're in the movie theater.
But you guys are professional 11-year-olds. Yeah. You're farting. You're throwing candy at people.
So we're sitting like this, watching the movie, and there's a balcony. Okay.
Yep.
And we're up in the second balcony, And instead of like whipping them at people, I'm just letting them go, right? Like, just
it's wherever they land.
It's gonna go through someone's skull.
So, you know, we're firebombing people, and they're the M&M ones.
The peanuts the big ones.
Yeah, the peanuts. They got substance to them. So we're whipping them off the top. Papa! And you can see them throughout the screen. You can see them. We're fucking howling in the back. But out of one of those peanuts, you hear it going. And it's just going. By the time it got to where we launched it, it was like the guy had a headache and everything. But it didn't break. It hit the guy's head and bounced off. So he held his head for a few minutes. He's looking back to see who could have done such a thing.
I would immediately think it'd be you two guys. Like, you didn't remember prime suspects.
I was sitting there. I'm pissing my pants. The guy's looking up. I'm fucking howling, right? Ralphie's having a heart attack. Ralphie don't know what to do, right? So he's like, Coco, you can get us thrown out of here because we're not. Eat the evidence. Don't worry about that. Right?
Oh my God,
we take the fucking...
What are you saying?
We take the fucking M&M peanut thing and we throw it behind us like it wasn't us. And that's it. Nothing happens.
Oh, that's so great.
Okay. The movie ends. Me and Ralphie are stoned to the gills. The movie ends. I had forgotten all about the peanuts. I had forgotten about everything. You understand?
Yep.
The movie was so good. I don't remember what the movie was. But I don't remember what the movie was, but I do remember that when the movie ended, you know, Ralphie didn't walk fast, and neither was I. I was in no shape. Maybe y'all remember that.
Yeah.
I was in bad shape. It must have taken us 20 minutes to walk downstairs. As we're making the turn, I had forgotten about everything. All I had in mind was he was going to take me to eat somewhere. We were going to go back to his house and make a sandwich. And the next thing you know, we walk around the turn. And the guy's got an ice pack on his head. He's got the M&M. And he's yelling at the manager, like, you have to fingerprint this and call the police. I was assaulted. And the manager's like, so do you want to press charges? He goes, yes. And me and Ralphie, it took everything. It took everything for us not to just howl. And we walked like 10 feet and just... There's things you forget and there's things you still remember. I still remember that walk, how we kept banging our legs like fucking howling, that we had both forgotten about the peanut. And here it is, this guy's got an ice pack on his head. He's completely bald and he's got the peanut like with a glove on.
Oh, he must have been crawling on the ground looking for
it. Oh my God. Oh my God.
It's the best stuff in
that's
life.
That's the shit that you really can't, you know. The day I'm supposed to meet him, I told you. And I couldn't. I went downstairs and I had a flat. They were doing construction when I lived on Schrader.
Okay. You didn't say, where were you supposed to meet him?
At the sushi place.
Okay.
And he was pissed. And he goes, what do you mean? I go, well, I used the spare, so I got no fucking spare. So I called the tie guy, and he's trying to get a size, and then once he can put it on for the $20, I'll go out to you. And he goes, where's the motherfucking car at? And I told him, I said, right in front of the house there. He goes, what's the address? I go, what are you going to do? He goes, don't worry about nothing. Watch this. He goes, what's the address? Give him the address. Dog, you know, I go upstairs. He calls me. He goes, are you downstairs? I go, no. He goes, go downstairs, give the guy your keys. Go downstairs, the guy tows my fucking car. Firestone on La Brea.
Oh, yeah.
Tows my car over there, and next thing you know, I got 400 brand new tires on the fucking car. Where you at, player? I gave an extra 300 so you can be in 20 minutes. Come on over.
Wow.
I ordered your sushi and lobster roll. You know, he would come back, like here I was, living in this dingy apartment. I didn't have nothing, you know. I was either still addicted or towards the end of it.
Mm.
And he would come back on Monday. Like if his plane landed at 4:40, he would pick me up at 7 o'clock, take me to the weed store. He would spend $2,200, $2,400, because he was going to West Palm Beach, and there were a bunch of pot smokers there, the waiters. So he wanted to make sure they had weed, and he wanted to make sure I had weed. That's when he used to take the weed and put it in his rolls. Lee, wake up. You're going deep.
No, no, no. Why would he put it in his rolls?
Hide it.
Because that's how he would hide it, in his rolls.
Oh, my God.
But he would come in and spend $2,000. He was spending $8,000 a month. His wife was going nuts because he would take it out of the T-shirt money. Mm-hmm. In those days, in 2005, 6, 7, 8, guys, he was coming home with manila envelopes and rubber band, a $5,000 denomination. And the rubber bands, there had to be 8 of them in there. That was merch.
Wow.
That wasn't even the door sales and the booze and nothing else. So he would fucking, in front of me, he would fucking go in his briefcase and take a fucking rubber band out. They were each $5,000. And we'd go into the fucking weed store, and he'd just go crazy. This is an edibles would be. And then, like, he would tell the guy, what's the best weed you got? That one. Give Coco an ounce. Give Coco an ounce of that. Give Coco an ounce of that. Give Coco cookies. I would leave there with $900 worth of weed that I would give away. Because Ralphie would give it to me. So I'd give it to Ari.
Yeah, pass it on.
I'd give it to Duncan. That's when we were like all struggling.
Yes.
And we were young.
Yep.
So Ari would get a call. Duncan would get a call. Red Band would get a call. So when I get to the Comedy Store, I'd give them all. That was Death Squad.
That's it.
It all went downhill. So everybody got a taste. And then I would tell Ralphie that I gave some to them. So now they would, how do you think Ralphie and Ari are so fucking tight? Like, I'm telling you, man, I know Ari a long time. Ari took a big hit with Freddie Soto.
Yeah, that one got me.
And this one is going to get for Ari, okay, too. Ari took a hit with Freddie Soto. You know, I knew Freddie, but I didn't really know Freddie as much as to take a big hit with him.
Yeah.
Ralphie, I was more personally involved with him, you know?
I remember visiting Ari 2 years ago in New York. It was a great night. Gabriel Iglesias brings me to New York. We land. Me and Gabe are having drinks at the bar. We get pizza. He's calling in the night. Ari's calling me. When are you getting here? When are you getting here? All right, because Ari's out to dinner with Justin. They're at some fancy place or whatever. I finally get to Ari. We meet Bill Murray, and we just walk from wherever we are an hour and a half to Ari's house, just through the streets of New York on a school night, Wednesday, 3 o'clock in the morning, and the phone rings, and it's Ralphie May. Because that's how tight Ralphie and Ari were. And he puts me on the phone with Ralphie. I'm in New York. I haven't even landed. I've been there 4 hours. Hang Gabe. Get to meet Bill Murray. Me and Ari are catching up. All right, player. Stevie Simone, you're a good man. And I'm just like, that's it. Because didn't Ralphie bring Ari out on the road for a while?
Yeah, he took all of us. He helped
everybody.
And you know, Lee, it was... I think I did 2 dates with him. Now... I loved Ralphie to death in those days. You know, Ralphie was a killer.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, I was a different type of killer.
Yeah.
So I would kind of scare his crowd. He took me to maybe, when he won the last comedy, he took me somewhere, Beaumont one time, and then we went to like a bigger room where I just bombed. But both times, Lee, he didn't know what he was giving me. I never worked with anybody like that before. Everybody sends me a check in the mail. This guy just went in his pocket and just handed you. Sometimes it could be $1,400.
Wow.
Sometimes it could be $800. Sometimes it could be $2,200. You know, he knew what I went through. He knew what I went through all those years. And when he hit, I was still fucking banging. And I could never look him in the face. But from time to time, he would slip me $100 or $200. The week I got the longest yard, he slipped me $200, like the day before I officially got it. And I always said it was from that lucky $200 he gave me, because that's when he was on fire. So he was supposed to go to Houston, and I got the longest yard. It was June of 2004. Something, I was supposed to go on a club date with him. And then when I canceled for the longest yard after that, somebody filled my spot. That's how it works. You don't cancel with Ralphie. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You got to start from the rotation all over again. You got to carry luggage and shit. But another time, were you around for his wedding?
No. I wasn't at the wedding, no, but I remember it.
You remember that one? That's weird, because there was nobody he didn't invite. Do you know what I'm saying? It's not like he didn't send invitations, like no more weddings. Like, I think he got married 3 times. I think so. He got married in Vegas, somewhere on the East Coast, and then he had a party here. On the Sunset, no, on Hollywood Boulevard. They tried to do comedy there. It was a place, and they served food, a star strip, strip star, something weird.
Yeah.
That was the name of the fucking place. Ralphie got married there. But when he got married, he sent the invites out. It didn't say Ralphie on it. It said Raffy, right?
It's great.
You know, it could only happen to him.
Yeah.
And he's got me as a buddy. You know what I'm
saying? Just more ammunition to break his balls.
Oh, yeah. For that whole week of the wedding, I kept calling him Raffy. Oh, no. And I told people to call him Raffy, and his face would turn red. He was so mad at the printer, he would fucking choke him. Even at the wedding, I said to him, so what's going on, Raffa? And he just froze. And he looked at his wife and he goes, hey, Lana, remind me not to pay the printer. Like, he was so furious at that fucking printer that he messed up his fucking name.
You had one job. You had one job.
Did you call him Raffy to the day he died? You probably called him...
No.
Listen, you stopped calling him Raffy?
I had to switch it up with Raffy because he's a professional comedian. It's like really a jiu-jitsu tournament. Before you fuck with Ralphie, you better come prepared and know how you're going to slip inside and get him to die of laughter. Ralphie loved it direct. Uh-huh. He didn't like you fucking around. That's why I could always get Ralphie on the phone. Ralphie liked when I was direct with him on the fucking phone. You know, like, I can't even imagine. I can't remember all the things I used to do to him just to torment his fucking life. Coco. Oh, my God. Like I said, people, it hasn't even soaked in. I have thousands of these, you know. There's thousands of these. I have a friend right now that I haven't spoken to in a long time. I have a couple of them, you know, that we were all there with them, man. And they have to feel as bad. Everybody. This is deep for a lot of people. Yeah. Trust me, I'm telling you. This guy was a good guy all the way around. And like I said, I saw some really, really negative things on Facebook, and I saw some really negative things on Twitter, and it really made me laugh, because if they really knew who this person was, regardless of what they heard. Because listen, there was 1,000 things. There was 1,000 people he helped.
Oh, yeah.
That you and I will never know about.
Yep.
Trust me, I'm telling you.
It's true.
You and I, he wasn't that type of dude, bro. If he helped you, it was between him and you.
Yeah.
That's it. Nobody else was involved. He wasn't braggadocio about it.
He did it because he wanted to do it. Came from his heart. Yeah.
So, yeah, you know, listen, man, I'm 54 years old. I lost both parents. I lost two of my favorite people in the world before I was 18. I know how this shit works. And if this is the final chapter in my life, I got to tell you something. He really added some flavor to it. From day one, you know, he was never a competitor. We were always, always very helpful to one another.
Team.
You know, he got me gigs. He got me so many fucking gigs. But if there's one thing I got to miss about him, isn't his generosity. It was our conversations on the phone. Our conversations on the phone. I don't know what I'm going to do about those. That's going to... We always ended up getting off the phone fucking howling. You know, we had mutual friends from Houston, so we would goof on them.
It's great.
It was just... But you know what, man? The beauty about these stories I'm telling you people is maybe you haven't heard them or heard them before. You guys heard him on the podcast. You guys felt his tenderness. You guys felt his loving. You guys felt how much of a good time he would have, you know. We all knew what he was going through. You heard the rumors or you didn't hear the rumors or whatever, but it didn't matter. Every time he came on here, he gave it everything we had. You know, again, and I hate this. I hate saying this. I love comedy. I love, listen, who doesn't love howling? I'm not talking about Saturday Night. That's so witty. It's so politically, oh my God, it's so socially environment. No. I'm talking about when you're keeled over and you're coughing your fucking lung out and your eyeballs are about to come out. It's a weird thing. For somebody to make you laugh that hard and they just make your day. My God. I'm about to have a heart attack right now, but that Bert Kreischer night, I can't even tell that story. That Bert Kreischer night, it was one of the funniest nights of my life. With the way, when he fell into the fucking kid's house.
I'm going to piss my pants.
This is it. This is it. The anxiety, I have no anxiety medication on me. It was just amazing. This motherfucking guy fell into a fucking toilet barber. Okay? And listen, you guys know, I have no reason to lie to you people. I'm a fucking animal. Give me a towel, please, or something.
Yeah, I have to.
Oh, no, don't get up over it. You know, you guys know I'm an animal and I love to laugh. Do you know what it is to want to laugh, but you can't because this is... Just picture your mother falling downstairs.
I got a piece of
If your mother fell down the stairs, would you fucking howl? I don't think so.
As soon as she was okay, maybe. You know what I'm saying?
How much do you love your mother? But if she fucking gobbled down the stairs and her wig fell off, would you laugh? No, it's your fucking mother. It was the same thing with Ralphie that night. And let me tell you something. We're sitting there. We're smoking. You know me, dog. You invite me to your house, I'm bringing a munition of weed. I'm like that Vegas shooter. I'm bringing everything with me. You know what I'm saying? You invite me over to your house for a podcast. I'm bringing edibles.
Whatever.
I'm just trying to be the best I can be. I'm showing up with the goods. You're inviting me over to your house. I know you get high. Yeah. I'm going to bring the best weed, the best edibles. So, you know, he invites me over. And I'm sitting there and we're waiting on Ralphie. You know, and I know Ralphie, dog. Every time we had him on this podcast, the first two times, I told Lee, listen, this is going to be one of these podcasts. We don't know when he's going to show. We'll give it an hour, and then we'll start the podcast. But out of his love for me, he always was. One time, I think he was 40 minutes late or something, but he showed up. He was solid. And, you know, some people, they just move a little slower, and I understood. But so the podcast is supposed to start at 8. This motherfucker shows up at 10. He sits on that fucking chair. You hear the wood like creaking the whole time. We do the podcast. He's fucking out of it, guys. Now, when I tell you out of it, we're family. Something else was lingering. Mm. If you want me to lie to you, I can't lie to you. Something else was lingering in the system. He's my brother. Me and Heavy, he's my brother. Mm. I don't say nothing. It's not for me to judge. We wrap up he's smoking the vapor pen. He just had that fucking pneumonia. Mm-hmm. Remember when they carried him off the ship and I asked him if he tipped over the helicopter and all that shit? You know, I used to torment his life. How many people had to carry him and the whole thing? And they took him off the ship and he went to the hospital and he stayed there for 3 weeks and they put a tube in his lung. So when he came home, he obviously took the tube out and he couldn't smoke reefer. But he was hitting that fucking vapor pen. Now, I got to tell you something. That vapor pen gets you high and all. But he's 500 pounds. That vapor pen, there's no reason why he should have been nodding, but it wasn't. So we got to wrap it up. It's fucking midnight. Bert's got three daughters, you know, two daughters. His wife is inside. We got to walk through the house.
Yeah, all quiet.
The dog is barking, and here's me and Ralphie walking through the house. So we open up the man cave. Bop, bop, bop. Bert walks out. I walk out second. Ralphie follows. I help him up. Boom, boom, boom. Me and Bert are talking about whatever the climate, whatever the fuck two comics talk about. What club are you going to next week? And all of a fucking sudden, you hear, pa, 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 pa. But you heard wood smashing. Like, when you hear wood smashing, it's real. Like, I thought somebody jumped out and attacked him, like three samurai or something. I turn around, and it's fucking Ralphie smothered with wood and splinters. He just broke fucking this whole thing.
Poor little girl.
I mean, guys, oh, my God. It world. Was something that... And I, you know... It was John Candy type comedy. Like, listen, guys, I got 1,000 of these that I forgot. Like, just him picking me up in North Bergen. Like, he came to my hometown and picked me up and drove me around maybe 3 times.
Wow.
And then after that, I even got a call from a teacher friend of mine who I'm going to see this week in Tampa. That was my teacher since I was a sophomore in high school. I hooked him up with Ralphie.
Wow.
And he called the other day and said, I can't believe Ralphie's fucking dead. That's terrible. So this is... No, I hooked Ralphie up with all my friends. Ralphie was tight with Mr. T. Ralphie was tight and loved George. My friend George, who Lee loved George. Whenever he was in Jersey, George would bring him ribs, pork fried rice from Chan's. So last I heard... They're not going to have a service. They're going to cremate the body. Like I said, they're going to get a lot of wood. All right? They're going to cremate the body, and then they're going to take him to... And they're going to have a reception in Arkansas with his family. They're going to do something in Nashville, but most important, they're going to do something in L.A. on Monday the 23rd or something like that. And we'll have to figure out how we're going to do this, Lee. But we'll figure it out one way or another. We're always a strong fucking team here. Hold on 1 second. Let me do a couple shout-outs here. Where are you going next, Steve Simone?
House of Comedy in Phoenix.
What is that?
October 25th.
Look at you. You just one night on?
No, 25th through the 30th. I'm there all week.
Okay.
It's like Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
Yeah, if you're in the Phoenix area, go over by the House of Comedy. Look at my man. Listen, I want to give some shout-outs. I can just imagine what Ookie Spooky's feeling like. You know, I love you, Ook. I can just imagine what D from Colorado is feeling like right now. You know, I love you. Jeffrey Collins, I'm always here. Bob Lalingus, I love you. Jose Torta Tuhi, I love you too. Ethics, Enthis. Anyway, I'm no fucking whatever. David Macca, Andrew G, MMA Dude Bro, Alex Paz with the podcast, and the rest of the fucking church family. Helping me out, keeping me fucking smiling all weekend. You motherfuckers, I owe you one. Don't forget, if you're in the Tampa area next weekend, I'm slinging dick and giving out fucking Swizzlers over at the Tampa Improv starting Thursday night. And the following Thursday, I'm in, oh shit, I'm in Lexington, KY on Broadway, Lexington, Kentucky. Bring that fucking homebrew. Bring the reefer. Bring everything you got, Kentucky. I don't give a fuck. Steve Simone, talk to me, my little brother. What's going on in your world?
Everything's okay, man.
You look good?
Yeah.
I mean, you're another guy that I've known you for...
Forever.
We've been here for... Like, and that's what Josh Wolf really... Like, Josh called in the afternoon. Like, Josh, it was really weird how the phone rang. And I tried to take as many as I could. To let people know, listen, this sport's cool. And Ari said it best. He goes, like I said, every time I saw him, I prepared for it. What Josh Wolf broke down to me is like, do you even remember what we were going through those days? Like, we were all fucking broke.
Yeah.
Barely putting it together. Josh Wolf had just had Jacob. You know, that was, comedy was the bright spot then. Yeah. Everything else was shit. I was starting to lose contact with my daughter.
Yep.
They were moving to England. It was just something that, you know, Josh Wolf had knocked. Like he said, he had the child. Now he's in a one-bedroom apartment with two of her kids. and a Great Dane and fucking his brother. And, you know, it was just something that everybody, just to let people know, man, that whatever, and it starts with Ralphie, whatever dream you got, it could be done. And we did it together. And I never realized that till Ralphie passed, that Josh Wolf brought it to my attention. That little click down there, that was a really cool time. That was a really cool time. And even if I wasn't going to Montreal, there was only one person who believed in me back then. And that's Mitzi Shore. That was good enough for me. That was good enough for me. Nobody else liked me. I couldn't get... My agent was the coloring book. And I had a fucking deal from CBS for a fucking show, and I couldn't get nobody to sign me.
Wow.
Let's draw cards on the fucking table here. I couldn't get nobody to fucking sign me. Help me out. I had somebody giving me $25,000, and I had nobody negotiating the deal because I didn't have an agent.
Wow.
I need an attorney, and a friend of mine goes, she's a great attorney. She's black, but she's a fucking savage. So I said, okay, I called. I got nothing against black people. I called, and that's what she was, a theatrical agent / attorney. So she goes, listen, you come in here with 25 G's, I'll give you a fucking shot. So she started repping me.
That's great.
But I had nobody. I showed up here with an envelope, like a fucking Cuban shows up to see a Jew. You show up with an envelope from day one. Mm. I couldn't get nobody to sign me, guys. That's how fucking I turned Pete. That's how bad it was for me. And it was that whole 2 or 3 years. It was like 4 years. I moved in with Terry in 2000. So I was on that corner for about 3 years. And Ralphie was the catalyst. I could tell you whatever fucking story I was, that I was doing this and that. That's a bullshit story. I was living in front of Ralphie's fucking door, cradled every night, with no sleep apnea machine, dying. Yeah. Just, I didn't think I had sleep apnea then, because I used to sleep all fucking night. But that's what Josh Wolf pointed out to me. And I think that's why I couldn't fall asleep Friday night. I'd forgotten all about that. I fucking hate when I forget shit. How many times Ralphie cooked. There was an incident that happened there one night on 9/11. When 9/11 struck, we opened up the day at Mike Faberman's house, including Joe Rogan. There was a lot of us in Mike Faberman's house. That was fucking nuts.
Yeah.
But then word got out. Ralphie was cooking a gumbo. Some people went home. That was my home over there.
Yeah.
Now, I was living with Terry at the time. I remember going over there that night, and I forget who was there. And here's Ralphie living off peanuts. It's 9/11, 2001. He's scraping by on fucking Visalia gigs and Rudy Moreno gigs and Willie Barsena gigs and Felipe Esparza gigs, just like the rest of us in those days.
Yeah.
You know, in fact, me and Ralphie would drive to a lot of those gigs together. Those Thursday, Wednesday, Tuesday gigs, we would do those constantly. That was our bread and butter. That's how you bought groceries.
Yep.
That was $40 a spot. That was $120 from Tuesday to fucking Thursday. You know, $10 for gas to get down there back and forth. Nobody even knows you're down there. And you get a couple tacos. Those guys were always cool. They give you a drink ticket and shit. You talk to a couple Spanish girls. Ralphie did all that shit.
Yeah.
Ralphie did the black rooms. That dude paid his fucking dues, Jack.
Funny's funny.
No, that's no mistake. That dude worked it. He was working door deals in Texas when we were starving. He would still go back to Texas and come home with $3,000-$4,000. Something that nobody does as a fucking whatever level.
Right.
He had built a little market somewhere. I forget where it was. Some fucking town. And he would go down there with John Westling or some other comics. And he'd fucking rape them, man. He was that strong even back then business-wise. So.
Yeah.
We're going to miss him.
For sure.
We're going to miss him in real life. We're going to miss him on the podcast. We're going to miss his shows. We're going to miss his advice. We're going to miss that fucking face. You know, the last couple of days you get on Facebook, you're having a good moment, and all of a sudden there's a picture of him, and you look at him, and it seems like he's staring right at you. And your heart melts for a minute. You're like, wait a second, I'm never going to see him again. Nah, this is bullshit. Your mind always rejects it at first. Like, this is bullshit. Like, And you guys talk about Joey. What the fuck do you know? Well, let me tell you something. I remember my mom died November of 79. I saw her in the casket. I saw him put her in the ambulance. I saw them close the casket and put it into a car. And then I saw them take it out of the car and wheel it to a hole and put it in there and throw dirt on it. And the next day I went by the fence because I lived two blocks away from the cemetery. And I saw them dig it, filling in the hole. Do you know that 18 months after that, once every 10 days when I get a couple cocktails in me, I would walk to my house and sit on the steps and walk around the back. Just to see Steve Simeone. Maybe it was a mistake. Maybe my mom went away to Florida and didn't tell me. You know, that's how fucking tricky your mind works. So I know the last 20 years here, my life has been wrapped on around Ralphie around one way or another.
Yeah.
You know, he filled the void for me that he was a guy that accepted me from day one. He just accepted me from day one, and he knew all the, you know, he knew everything, though. I could tell him anything. He didn't give a fuck. He really didn't. He never judged me. That's what made me love him more than anything in life, that he knew everything move that went down in my life. Mm-hmm. He knew everything crazy. He was in the car that night. All right. Steve Simeone, I got a call.
Mm-hmm.
From my friend's ex, this little hot Filipino. I mean, fucking smokingly. Steve Simone, she's smoking. Yeah. Smoking. I meet her once or twice, you know, Drugville. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And the first time I see the skirt she's got on and the heels, and I go, ooh.
You know what's up.
This is a fucking, this chick's banging. She was Americanized, but she had the black hair and the beautiful dark eyes. So, it's a Sunday night. I'm watching football like everybody else at 5 o'clock, and the phone rings. I had a cell phone back then. Yeah. It's got to be 2006.
Okay.
And I get a call at about 5 in the afternoon, and it's a woman's voice. And she goes, do you know who I am? And I go, no. And she goes, it's... And I go, what's up? And she goes, nothing. Can I talk to you about something? And I go, yeah. And she goes, listen, I got a big role in a movie. It's going to be like 3 weeks of work, guaranteed. But I need to pay SAG. And they want like $1,800 or something. I don't know what the number was then. And I just want to know if I could borrow it from you. And I'll do it. Now listen, I got $3 in my pocket and $22.50 in the bank account. See what I'm saying? They're ready to shut it down.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I'm waiting on the tips to come in. Before they shut it down. You know when you tip people, it don't come in right away, and then you look at your account and you're $22 light.
Yeah.
And you're like, fuck, that's right, I put tips down and shit. Well, okay. So this girl's telling me, you know, she needs a $17.50, whatever, if I can help her out. Blah 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 blah. So you know me. I can make a call for her. But let me see what you know. I go, so what's going on? How are we gonna work this out? And she goes, well, you'll give me the money. I'll pay SAG tomorrow. I think I start working next week in Seattle. And when I come back, I'll hand you the money. And I go, but what if you don't? I go, well, let me see the contract and stuff like that. Let me see who the production. She goes, well, I go, let me get the name of it. Is it on IMDb? Yeah. I go on IMDb. There ain't nothing for this movie. And I go, look, I'm pre-production and nothing on that. So I go, listen, I don't see nothing on this. Do you have sides for it or anything? And she goes, well, he gave us the sides, but then he rewrote them. And I go, who else in the movie? And she blurred a bunch of big names. And I go, okay. Well, there's nothing in here on it. I just, I go, listen, let's make this easy. I go, forget the payment. Let me just give you $17.50 and let's go to a hotel room. Let me, you know, let me work it off that way. And there was like a little silence. And I'm like, I got $3 in my pocket.
Right.
And like I said, maybe $22. She's like, what do you think you want? No, she's like, she's a little shy. She goes, what do you want to do? And I said, I'll eat your whole monkey and maybe I'll give you a little stabbing.
A little stabbing.
And there's like a little pause in there, you know. There's like a little pause in there. And she's like, well, I don't know. I just broke up with my boyfriend. I'll feel weird. I go, listen, don't worry about nothing. 17, 15. Nobody knows nothing.
Don't worry about nothing.
No, let me tell you, 17, 50.
The 17, 50 you don't have.
Yeah. But I got to push the envelope, right? So she's like, so what do you want to do? I go, listen, let me go over and give you a stab and eat your monkey. And I go, let me come in your mouth and shit. She goes, well, I don't do that. I go, listen, for 17.50, you got to do what you got to do. You know me, dog. I'm a savage.
Yeah.
And there was silence, right? And she goes, okay, where do you want to meet? And I go, where are you? And she goes, well, I'm close to like Huntington. I go, well, listen, is there Four Seasons somewhere close to you? And she goes, yeah, there is. Marina Del Rey. I go, let's go there. I'm going to get a suite. I'm going to fucking fuck you for fucking 10 hours. She's like, well, no, I have to leave by like 2. And I go, bring the skirt. And I started just taunting her. And I go, bring the skirt. Bring the heels. Bring the Catholic skirt. Bring the dildo. And you could hear her like, oh, this turned into something I didn't like. So, okay, I hang up with her. I'm giggling. I get a little giggle just to see how far I could push it.
Yeah.
In my mind, she's never going to call back, right?
It's like a prank phone
call. Right. It's like a prank phone call. I'm sitting there watching fucking TV.
You forget. Right? Totally, yeah.
I'm sitting there watching TV. I forget, and the phone rings, and boom, Ralphie May. What's up? What's up, dog? I'm downstairs. Let's go get some food. Let me hook you up for the week. It was a Sunday. I wasn't expecting Ralphie on Sunday.
Yeah.
Ralphie always came back on Monday, so I either get a call Monday night or by Wednesday he'd show up and let's go buy a pound of weed.
Yeah.
But this was a Sunday night, so I go, all right, I'll be right down. I take a shower. Ralphie's downstairs in a brand new fucking car.
Yeah.
I get in there. He hands me $200 right off the bat. You know, Ralphie was just pimping back then. We get in the car. We go over to Cushmart. We buy another $2,200 worth of weed, and now we're going to eat sushi somewhere. Mm-hmm. We weren't going to an expensive place. I forget where we're going. And the next thing you know, my phone rings. And I look at the phone, and it's this chick.
Uh-huh.
So I answer it, and Ralphie, I go, Ralphie, I'm going to pick this up. Don't say a word. Don't laugh. I go, this chick wants me to give her $1,700. And I'm telling her she wants to suck my dick and all this stuff. And he starts,
loving it.
Ralphie, stop it. Don't say a fucking word. Beep, what's going on, love? Okay, so where do you want to meet? I go, did you look at the directions? Hold on one second.
Did you look at the directions?
I go, did you look at the directions? Where is it? She goes, it's in Marina Del Rey. I go, all right, I'll meet you in Marina Del Rey. She goes, I got to ask you something. She goes, so how long do you want to hang out for? I go, well, how long do you got? She goes, so I have to meet the producer in the morning, pick up the script and stuff. I go, what time is it right now? And she's like, it's 8 o'clock. I go, listen, I'll meet you at 10. All right, and we'll hang out till about 1. That's it. We won't do much. You know me. I come real quick, but I go, listen. Ralphie's right there. He's just looking at me. The car is stopped.
Yeah.
And I'm like, listen, you know me. I'm not going to do anything to you. I come in a minute. All right? I'm gonna eat a little monkey. I'm going to suck that fucking noodle. And then I'm going to put my fucking dick in it. I want you to lick it. I'm going to put it in there. Ralphie's like trying to fucking not to laugh. And I'm trying not to laugh. And then I go, listen. And then I'm going to flip you over. I'm going to lick your asshole. And then I'm going to light that asshole on fire. Right? And all of a sudden you hear like a pause. And she goes, can I call you back? And me and Ralphie
died.
And I'm like, listen, okay, call me back. And me and Ralphie are fucking dying. I tell Ralphie, because I forgot all about it. I tell Ralphie the whole story and we're dying. I forgot how I told her it. I was like, listen, I'm going to lick your pussy. I'm going to fucking stick it in you. I'm going to put my dick in your mouth. I want you to suck it and get it hard. Then I'm going to flip you over. I'm going to lick your asshole. And then I'm going to lick your asshole on fire. Like, I acapella'd this. And she, I could hear her whole demeanor change on the other side.
She freezes.
Like she thought it was just going to be like, I'm going to go and feel her up and she's going to leave. I'm like, no, 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 no. If you go, I'm going to wear that asshole out. And it was hysterical. She called back. I had forgotten about her again.
Did she call back again?
Yeah, she hung up, said she'll call me back to see if she can meet me, which I knew she would never call back. Just from her reaction on the phone.
Yeah.
I knew she was never going to call back. And while we're eating sushi at that place off Sunset, now I know where we were, she called back and go, Ralphie, hold on, it's her. And I'm like, what's going on? And she's like, listen, it's off. I got my uncle to front me the money. And I could pay him in 3 payments. Thank you, though, when she hung up the phone. And about a week later, I was on fucking Facebook and she unfriended me.
Oh, my gosh.
Hilarious.
Ridiculous.
But listen, she had, I thought if I tell the whole story, she was taunting me from day one. When I met her the first 2 or 3 times, I met her she had a guy. She always had a boyfriend with her. We bought weed at the same spot.
Yep.
And then we hung out a couple times socially, but it was always with her boyfriend. Nothing ever happened. I never said nothing.
Right.
And then one day I see him and I go, what's going on? We're talking. You know, we all hung out together. And he goes, I don't date her no more, dog. I just, me and her broke up. That's it. And I never saw her again.
Yeah.
I never thought of her, nothing. And one day, dog, I'm walking. I hear peep, peep. And I look in the car and it's her with a low cut blouse.
Right.
No bra on. Those medium row breasts just staring in the face.
Oh my God.
The sun bouncing off them. And when I get to the car, she's got like a miniskirt on. And you can see the black underwear on. I'm like, oh. And she goes, Uncle Joey, I need help. I go, what's up? She goes, I need like $55 for gas. And I go, sure, $55 for gas. And I said, I got like $42 on me. Take this. And I was a complete gentleman. I just thought that maybe, you know what? I'm an older man. Maybe I'll show him my monkey and I'll move on with that. But something else happened after that that I could see she wanted to play with fire.
Yeah.
Like about a month later, she did something.
Should be the name of your show.
Yeah.
Playing with fire.
Playing with fire. Like she didn't know that I would take her ass to the hoop. Like she came back for more money. And I didn't ask her this time. Like, I was like, I didn't think about it, really.
Yeah.
I didn't see the pattern coming. And then she asked me for money the second time, and I was like, wait a second. Something's not right here. She just bumps into me on the street.
Yeah.
She looks like she just came from a photo shoot from a barn with no fucking bra on and black undies on, and she gives me a glance on monkey.
She knew what she was doing.
Now she needed headshots or something. And then something else happened. And I was like, something's not right here.
Yeah.
Something's not right. Let's see where this is going to lead. And sure enough, 6 weeks later, she falls into the crutches of debt. She calls Uncle Joey and tries to bang him out for $17.50.
Come on.
On a tit show and maybe like a finger bang and I love you and all this shit. And I was like, it ain't gonna go down that way. Number one, don't shave your monkey. She's like, why? Once you tell him that right off the bat, you just destroyed everything. There's no comeback for that in that little girl's handbook. When the guy calls you and says right off the bat, not even hello, I opened up with don't shave that monkey. What are you talking about? Don't shave that fucking monster.
Don't shave it.
Leave that fucking hairy monster. She said, what are you talking about? You know what I'm fucking talking about.
Hilarious.
It was hysterical how I psychologically broke her. She actually thought she was going to call me and trick me into just me giving a fucking
$2,000.
I'll give it to you, but you got to work a little something. You got like a nut.
Something.
You know what I'm saying?
I gotta go to the bathroom. Is it all right if I take a break?
And Ralphie's keeping it together during all this?
Ralphie howled. Hold on.
All right.
Thank you. Here, take it. Right here. Okay. I don't want you peeing all over.
I drank too much water.
When she called into the car, I never thought I was going to get that call. So I had to break it down to Ralphie real quick, like what was going on.
Oh my God.
Like, Ralphie, when I take this call, do not laugh. This girl tried to borrow $1,700 from me. and for SAG, and I told her that I wanted to have sex with her on the goof. I go, Ralphie, I'm flat broke. but dog, let me tell you something. It's crazy how many people, especially women, will try to backhand you like that. That wasn't the first time. And guess what? Like, the first time you do it, I'll make believe like you don't know what I don't know what you're talking about. But the second time, I'll play the hand, even though I don't even have the money. Like, I'll torture you a fucking little bit if you're going to be that fucking stupid and bother me with something like that. And it's crazy.
How far could it have gone? Like, what if she was like, okay, I have the room?
Oh, then I just would have told I got a flat tire. Keep waiting. Pay for the room and wait for me. I'll be there a half hour.
Oh, my God.
Lisa, what the fuck? If you're going to have a good time, you're going to have a good time.
Would you just torment women just to
No.
Well, not like in a bad way, but just like listen, goofy wise.
Listen, in life, hold on.
I feel so much better. Thank you. Perfect. Thank you.
I have to explain myself on some. As my friend here, Steve Simone, who was one of the nicest people in Hollywood and nicest people at the Comedy Store. There's a lot of nice people at the Comedy Store. They're young people, but Steve Simone's one of the most respected guys. He's a sweetheart of a guy. When you first got to the store, how many swindlers were there?
All of every.
Okay.
Yeah.
So,
it was a different place.
Now, what was the percentage was meant? 95%.
Yeah.
She was a female swindler. You know? And you bump into a female swindler sometimes.
Yep.
People come at you in Hollywood with a good heart. And there's a lot of people who take advantage of you.
Absolutely.
It happened to the kid who died. It happens to a lot of people that have a little bit of money and they come out here. Somebody finds out you have money, they latch on to you.
Yeah, there's a lot of desperation out here. And there's a lot of people coming out here for whatever reasons. And it makes them a vulnerable target.
Yes. So it's sometimes most of the people that approach you are male. But every once in a while, it's females trying to put you together. And that's when you don't have money.
Yes.
I was trying to get cranked on when I didn't have money. When you have money and you're young in this town, they come out from all directions. I had a friend once that got on a TV show. He was on a TV show, a popular show for like a year. He wasn't even a main character. But he was with a big-time agency in 1999. It was a drama.
Mm-hmm.
He was a comic from the Comedy Store. He was like one of those Sunday guys.
Okay.
But he was acting. And I remember he was like with a shit agency, and he went in on one of those cop dramas on CBS and got it. And there was that's when they used to give you, you know, the 17-episode orders. This was an hour drama. This kid disappeared and was making buku bucks. I forgot what the moral was of the story here.
Swindlers. People coming at you.
What the fuck? I'm sorry. Oh, no. That's right. So he was like not the number one guy on the show, but the show was popular on CBS, and people would recognize him from time to time.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, he moves into this fucking building, and he goes, within the fucking fourth day, he sees a girl in the elevator. And the girl says to him, so you moved in here? Yeah. My name is whatever. I'm whatever. She makes believe, like, you know, everything's cool. He says, like, a week later, I bump into her again. I start talking to her. She says, we should go out sometime, blah, blah, blah. At dinner, he goes, I'm just being casual with her. I didn't even hit her up for sex. He goes, I wasn't even thinking about it at that point. You know, we weren't even in that realm.
Mm-hmm.
And out of nowhere, I tried to be honest with her because two people came up to me at the restaurant and said that they liked the show. So when I tried to tell her what it was, she played it off in a weird way.
She knew.
So he goes, they're driving home, and he's taking her back to a car, and she pulls over and she goes, listen, can you help me out with something? And she thought it was like a ride to the house. Maybe she had a flat tire. She said, listen, I'm in a bind. Can I borrow $3,000 from you? And he said he had never ever, but if you see this guy, you know, I don't want to say his name, I don't want to embarrass him, but if you see this guy, he's a really good looking dude. He's buff. I think he's still around. I don't know. But he said he wanted to go home and cry. First date, whatever. Met her, hello, goodbye. This is a different world out here.
Yeah.
You know, this is a different world out here, and I'm really sorry that they're not having a memorial, like a big time memorial somewhere. Like, I think they're going to have one in Nashville. I think I'll have to go to one of them and pay my respects. You know what I'm saying? The one in L.A. is going to be a little bit too phonyized. I think TMZ will be there and all that shit. And you know what? That's the last thing I want to fucking do on a Monday night. I got a podcast with you cocksuckers. I've been friends with him for 20 years. I went through highs and lows with him. You know what? I don't need to stand in line and make some stupid fucking speech in front of a bunch of people that at the end don't give a fuck anyway. They just want to be where the hot place is going to be. And I'll be here with you motherfuckers doing a podcast. What else? You're going to tape a CD soon? You're going to make a kid's book?
What's going
on? Every time I talk to you, listen.
I got a little web series called It's Still Broken.
Okay.
I have a buddy that can fix everything. So he taught me and Eric Griffin last week how to fix a toilet, which is, I actually learned how to do it, which is good. And then I showcased for, hopefully I'll get that Comedy Store special, which would be great. And got the road coming up.
Who wants to shoot them now?
Well, I think the store wants to do it themselves. They have different investors, but I showcased, I think they're going to give one to Ingram. I showcased, Jesus Trejo showcased. He's a good kid. Jamar Neighbors. A lot of funny young guys were up there showcasing. So hopefully I got a shot.
And they'll shoot them all in the main room?
I don't know. I haven't heard any details at all.
That'd be great. The main room looks like it'd be a great place to shoot a little something with some people back there. You know, years ago, I want to congratulate Felipe Esparza again, but I also want to congratulate my dear friend who was one of the guys that put the whole thing together. He started as a comic. Remember? He used to open up and work a lot with Jimmy Shue, but he's out of Florida.
Claude Shires.
I want to really thank and congratulate Claude Shires for getting his work on HBO. He shot it.
Claude directed that?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. So
two Comedy Store guys, one special. That's awesome.
Yeah. So that's what it works out like. So I want to congratulate him too, and thank you guys for supporting that special. Anything else you want to tell these fucking savages? Talk to me, baby. Talk.
Just like what you said before, just tell the people that you love that you love them and hug them. You know,
Lisa, what do you want to say about Ralphie? I know he loved you. I mean, he come in here and he would call me, and I tell him what type of torture I'd be doing to you, and he would add some techniques to torture you with.
Well, I get the question a lot, like, who's my favorite church guest? And it's hard. Like, we get a lot of great people in here, and like I don't really have favorites. It's weird, but it was always great when Ralphie would come. It was always great when Ralphie would come, and he was one of the few people who I met who was who they were, like who I wanted them to be.
Mm.
Like I grew up a fan of Ralphie. I remember Last Comic Standing. I remember the special with the orange jacket, and he was great the first time I met him. Gave me a big hug, and we were at an office a few blocks away from In-N-Out, and at like 1 a.m. after, I think the whole podcast was you like joking with me about losing weight or something. And then he asked me to go get burgers at In-N-Out. It's like, you know, man, I'm going to try to be good. And later you're like, you know what, you should have gone. He would buy you like 20 burgers and give you like $1,000. I was like, oh, I didn't know. But I'll never forget the night with the yellow snake. That's one of the best nights of my life.
What happened with the yellow snake?
His bracelet, his son made him. That when we were doing that stuff, it actually did calm me down to like focus on it, but then when he scared me with it and freaked me out, that like, what's funnier than that?
He is I'm definitely going to miss him doing the podcast. But I'm going to miss him more, like I said, our conversations on the phone. Sometimes I'd be having a rough day. And he would call me. And I would just laugh. I'd ask him where he was. I'd know exactly where he was. I'd make a local reference. We'd laugh for a while. It's going to be a big fucking chunk. But like I said, right now I'm just processing it. And you guys were fucking great. That's it.
That's it.
That's it.
It just sucks. It's weird dealing with it. It's different dealing with it as like a child and then dealing with it as an adult.
No, since it's happened, I've had a weird feeling behind my heart. It could be that burp. Sometimes you have a little burp twisted behind your heart. You go to the doctor, they'll tell you, go take a good fucking stomach ache shit and watch that little pain go away. You got a little backup back there. You got to eat more vegetables and shit. But no. I know your people are hurting and we're fans. And thank you very much for all the support. And I want to thank Steve for coming on and sharing. And Lee personally knew him and knew him personally. And you guys know the deal with me and him. I wish him peace.
Me too.
I wish God heals him.
Amen. For sure.
You know, right now, like I said, I'm a Catholic person. And I could just see him seeing Marilyn, hugging her right now. David Crowder and then Freddie Soto, and they're just hugging each other right now.
Yeah.
Going, what happened? And they're like, I left Coco down there. He's got my babies. He's got Lee Syatt, you know. Right now, he's hugging Marilyn. And they're hugging. And remember when I deep fried the turkey? It's going to be Marilyn's 10th year anniversary next month.
Oh, my God.
It's the 10th year anniversary of me doing blow, 10 years. Never did cocaine again. Fucking tremendous. Life shifts. If you're down, don't fucking write it down. You just heard the fucking stories that made, you just heard the stories that I have from one of the greatest fucking comics I ever came across. And I judged him as a comic on stage, but he was like the Roberto Clemente of comedy. He gave everything he had to his fans. He gave everything he had to his family, and he gave everything he had to his friends. You're hearing it from me. Do not believe anything else you hear. Listen, he did his fucking reefer. He did a couple fucking drugs from time to time. He smoked his pot. He loved his children. Everything he did was with them in mind. Trust me, I'm telling you, we had deep conversations. I don't know what's happened the last 2 years, and I don't want to know. It's none of my business. What's my business is that he's in a better place. He'll always have a piece of my heart with him, and I'll have a piece of his heart. And I thank you people, because I don't know how I'm going to deal with this from time to time. Now, and listen, guys, I can feel that. Let me tell you what I'm starting to feel. A little bit of anger. I can't lie to you people. I felt it today. I fucked up today. I got caught. My wife didn't go to church today, so I got caught up with them. I couldn't go to jiu-jitsu. And it was a big fucking mistake. And I had two kids' parties. So I couldn't even work out today. It was one of those days that 1:40 I could feel anger. And it's all directed from Ralphie May. Like that, it's starting to hit me that way now. So now I got to deal with that. I got to go to jiu-jitsu tomorrow and do 2,000 fucking jumping jacks and burn that fucking bullshit up. That's what it's doing to me. As I felt it today, I took blood pressure medication. I was like, this ain't bueno. This ain't bueno, cocksuckers. But I'm not going anywhere. I'm getting my checkups. That's another thing. A lot of people sent me messages saying to, I'm with you. Guys, Steve Simone, am I a different man or am I a different
man? Absolutely.
I drink water all the fucking time. Last night I drank a fucking little bit of soda with this mamook over here, with Moose Jr. And I had a good time at Bert Kreischer's.
You had some pizza with pesto.
It was really nice at Bert Kreischer's. No, I didn't have the fucking pizza with the pesto and the goat cheese. I was embarrassed. And then they put sriracha on it to really throw me over the top. It was a green pizza, as it was. It looked like somebody vomited. It looks like a cat vomited. You know how they, when if you make if you make shrimp and lobster sauce and take everything out,
yeah,
egg white vomit.
Oh yeah, yeah.
That's what the pie looked like, only with green pesto on it and goat cheese to boot.
Thank you for having me, Bert.
To really insult the fuck out of me, okay? And then to really boot, they went, him and his tamunkia buddy went and got that fucking hot sauce, sriracha, and we're putting sriracha on pizza.
The slice I saw looked good, though. It was old school, just plain cheese.
Pepperoni. That was the last slice. Well, Lee ate like 22.
I had two slices, and
Lee even took one in his jacket. He didn't think I could smell it in the cup.
I didn't wear a jacket.
I could smell the slice in his jacket. I know he didn't have no hummus packed on his neck. I went to a party today, a kid's party, they had hummus. And I just walked away from the table. I didn't want to leave no evidence just in case I snapped. They had hummus with tomato on it with little fucking nice little Italian breads. What a waste of Italian bread.
I was going to say, it's tough to find good bread out.
And then they had like three pepperonis. I swallowed them all before any of those fucking Gentiles had a heart attack. You eat three pepperonis, you're fucking done. I had a good week this week, dog. I went to gymnastics class.
Aww.
I went to ballet class. I went to a kid's birthday party. I went to, like I said, my wife didn't go to fucking church this morning, so I ruined my morning. But I got to spend time with them. We went to two parties today. It was quite a weekend. Next week, Tampa bitches. And the weekend after that, Lexington, Kentucky. Then the week after that, it's Halloween, motherfuckers. And I'm at home. I got like a fucking recital on Friday night. I got like a fucking Halloween costume with I'm Superman.
Oh, that's awesome.
Saturday night. We'll keep you posted, motherfucker. See you in Tampa. Steve Simone, I want to thank you.
Thank you for
Steve Simone, I want to thank my man, the Christ Killer, Lee Syatt, I want to thank you. And I want to thank the spirit of Ralphie May for guiding me in comedy the last 20 years, because that's what he did. He fucking forced me to be a better comic when he'd tell me little things from time to time. So, this podcast is out of respect for Ralphie May. I hope he's in a better place now. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you guys for listening. Have a great week. Stay black. Have a happy, ambiguous day. Ever since you yanked Columbus Day, you fucking liberals. Now what are you going to do? Anyway, listen to my church people. We all want to eat better. Like I told you in the beginning of the show, all right? We all want to eat better. We really try. When it comes to snacks, sometimes it feels like the whole world is delicious and a billion calories versus boring and tasteless. You ever wake up in the middle of the night and all you want is an Oreo? How many Oreos can you eat at 2 in the morning? You ever think about that? But no. If you eat that stuff, it's terrible for you. You get diabetes, the whole goddamn thing. It's not good. You shouldn't have to be that way. You got to up your snack game with Nature Box. Now, Nature Box, that's the snack of champions right there. Nature Box has 100 snacks that taste good and are actually better for you. All snacks are made from high quality, simple ingredients, which means no artificial flavors, colors, sweeteners, nothing. So you can feel good about what you're eating. You understand me? My favorite, I mean, I got a ton of favorites. I got the garlic plantain. I got the salt and vinegar veggie chips. I got the mini Belgian waffles. There's a ton of things I like. Look at me. Listen, you're sure to find your new snack obsession with Nature Box. They add new snacks every month, inspired by real customer feedback. You, that means the latest food trends and professional chefs. It's so simple. Just go to naturebox.com, choose the snacks you want, and Nature Box will deliver them right to your door. So you go over to the page, you see what they want, or you're in the you go to the bestseller page. You got the white cheddar caramel popcorn. You got the cheddar and Hatch chili crackers. You got the garlic plantain, the sour cream and onion straws. I mean, it never stops. The almond butter, the mocha almonds, the pistachio almond mix, the coconut cashews, the blueberry nom noms. Listen to me. This is the way to go. If you want a snack and you want to feel good, Nature Box is the way to do it. And it's simple. Go to naturebox.com, choose one of those snacks I just told you, and Nature Box will deliver it right to your door. Who's better than Nature Box? Nobody. And there's no risk. If you ever try a snack you don't like, don't eat it. Nature Box will replace it for free. What did I just say? Free. They'll replace it for free, okay? So take a chance. Columbus did. You want to try the garlic plantains? Bam! Try them with confidence, because Nature Box will work with you. Number two, what I'm going to do for you tonight is this, out of respect. Right now, Nature Box is offering the Church of What's Happening Now, right now, the family, 50% off your first order when you go to naturebox.com/Joey, J-O-E-Y. That's naturebox.com/Joey, J-O-E-Y, for 50% off your first order. Hey, listen to me. Naturebox.com/Joey. It's that easy. You'll be feeling better about yourself, more confident, and you'll be eating healthy. Who's going to be better than you? Number two. You people know I'm a gambling enthusiast. You need help, I'm here for you. That's what Uncle Joey does. You understand me? Lee, am I lying to you? Do we not have one conversation or not about how you're mush and the whole thing, and I don't keep you, I keep you away from the action because, you know. But anyway, that's not here to say. Why are we talking about poor Lee? Leave fucking Lee alone, Joey. Leave him alone. Anyway. It's football season. It's about, you're 2 weeks away, 3 weeks away from basketball season. Then guess what happens after that? You're 3 weeks away from NFL playoff season. Then it's college basketball and bowl season. And there you are. You haven't made a dime all season. And you know what? Before every game, you're not too bad. Why are you doing this? Why are you watching these games? And start to make some gains. Start to make some money with this. MyBookie is the industry-leading website that hooks you up with all your betting needs. You understand me? From novice to professional. And they're and with their great odds, fast payouts, and decades of expertise, you can bet with confidence. You understand what that feels like? To throw a couple G's down and go eat a cheesecake and go to bed and wake up the next morning and know the Gidas is going to be there? That's my bookie. Your team doesn't even have to win. They just need to cover the spread. What are you waiting for? Lay down some cash and win big today. If you know your team sucks, do yourself a favor and bet against them. If they lose, you'll make money. And if they win, you'll still be happy, all right? Where you bet is just as important as who you're betting on. That's why I'm urging you people to make your way to my bookie. Why? Because I trust them. They've been around, and you got to take my word for it. Check them out yourself. They have in-game live betting and a mobile site that makes wagering on the go easier than ever. You can also check out the online casino if you'd rather just play a few hands of blackjack or roll the dice with craps. That's how good MyBookie is. So do me a favor, all right? Join now, and MyBookie will match your deposit with up to 100% bonus. Use promo code CHURCH, C-H-U-R-C-H, to activate this offer. Visit mybookie.ag, uppercase. Again, mybookie.ag, uppercase. Use the promo code CHURCH right now. It's this simple. You play, you win, you get paid. Why sit there with a bunch of winners if you ain't winning money? Go to mybookie.ag right now. Tell them Uncle Joe.